Welcome to the Abby and Anthony Show.
Never before has one radio show been so extreme. So vulgar.
Fuck you, I'm not a pussy.
I was accustomed to getting blown and having my ass eaten.
This is insane. I mean, this is insane.
So flatulent.
Why do we even try? Let's just fart into the mics and call it a day.
This is the funniest shit ever.
It's a weird show.
That's what's real. That's sex.
Oh,
tune in with no expectations.
Quite simply, the greatest show in the history of broadcasting.
Here we are.
The Opie and Anthony Show.
Another 4 hours of love.
You guys having a good time or what?
Yeah, check, yep, check it. I'm up early in the morning, yawning. Put Opie Anthony, yeah, Jimmy Tranny pointing. Opie like brother, man, Ant wants to join the clan. Jimmy on the other hand, he working the other hand.
Trimming my headphones up.
They're horrible people, what they say in this old. Objectionable human beings, and I want you to know. Unacceptable to my scene, but I'll give it a go. 50 Cent, Larry King, Opie and Anthony Show.
I know you're feeling the flow, but Opie's mother hucking things trying to get blown. Don't come to play around and we still in the show. I know you never heard nothing like this before.
How important is the board? Board you'll never be, and don't worry about getting shot when you're with Anthony. Oh yeah, on the edge of York, yeah. Cause you really want to hear Opie, Anthony, and Jimmy. Just keep it right here.
This is the Opie and Anthony Show.
Yeah.
Enough
of this.
What's plava? Enough of this plax.
It's like the very old man version of palaver.
Yeah, yeah, plava. Well, good morning, everybody. How did this, anyway? What fun. Dealing with the heat, anybody? Oh, boy, let me tell you. Another scorcher here in the Northeast. The rest of the country's like, what? Like it all. And then you get three or four warm days strung together, and they're like, well, when is this heat wave going to end?
I like that the news has come on, though, and reminded us. Some things you may want to do is in pants.
Shorts. If you're feeling hot, get out of the sun.
Right.
If you can get into the shade, we recommend that. Let's see. Check the elderly. You got to check on those elderly. They don't know what to do. They've made it all these years, but they have no clue what to do in the heat, I guess.
How about, like, once they become the elderly, just make sure you buy them air conditioners.
Air conditioning for the elderly.
Yeah, why not?
That's a good charitable... charity to get behind.
Yeah, because the news always says how, you know, what terrible shape they're in once it gets hot.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I guess they can't afford it. They need, like, family members, and usually family just goes, bah, to the elderly. Bah!
Sweat it out.
They've lived their life. It's time I live mine. Buy grandma a fucking air conditioner, or I've had my eye on a nice TV.
Right. They start thinking about childhood memories of all the times they couldn't have the AC on when they were a kid.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's like, well, guess what? Mom.
Yeah. It is such a big thing, that fucking AC, going to people's houses sometimes, it's like, is the AC on? No. We don't use it unless what? It's fucking 95 degrees. How much warmer does it have to be before you flip that on?
My dad used to be like that in our house when we were growing up, and now to this day, when you're driving up to the house, like if I'm going to dinner or something,
yeah,
you got to look at the windows. Because if you see the windows open and you see the screens,
oh no,
it's 90 degrees. Why?
At that point, it's not even refreshing to open the windows. It's just sweltering out.
Yeah.
And there's some, I don't know. You know, I guess when some people say, Anthony, you're out of touch. You're wonderful. Hilarious, fucking great person.
Handsome.
Handsome. But you're out of touch when it comes to financial matters because you've been launched into a financial category that many have not attained. So I run that AC like a motherfucker, like it's just a fan. That's all. Like, oh, turn the fan on.
Like,
bet. Six fucking zones of cranking refrigeration. That's my house.
Of course I'll leave it on when I'm not home. Then it will be cool when I get home.
As we speak, my house is a chilly 70 degrees in every room. Rooms I haven't been in months.
They're all 70
are
degrees.
The comfort of 70 degrees.
When I wake up in the morning, my bedroom is very cool because, you know, the door's been shut and the AC's been on all night. But then I open the door and walk out into the rest of the apartment.
Oh, boy.
Sweltering.
Yeah.
And the cat's just lying down, like, with his stomach. It's up like, in the air.
I got a fur coat. I can't even take it off. This sucks.
Yeah, I mean, I'll have the AC on when I'm home in the room that I'm in if it's hot.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not. I guess I'm not there either, where I'm leaving the AC on and keeping it a cool 70 degrees.
All around the house, I like keeping it cool. So I guess I can't really get that whole thing, but I just don't understand how much more is it? Is it a lot of money to run that AC?
I don't know.
I mean, to the point where you just don't fucking use it.
No, but it can add up to the point where
it's an add up thing
where people might only have one air conditioner instead of two.
Right.
We have one in our living room. We don't have one in our bedroom.
Oof. How the fuck do you do that?
Because when you live in an apartment so small. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's not that bad.
Oh, you leave the door open and the AC from one room creeps right into the other.
Yeah, but then sometimes when it's like 105, there's nothing you can do. Like, we have fans in our bedroom.
Oh, do you try to redirect the air conditioning air into the room? Do you bank it off the wall, a little fan through the door kind of a thing?
Like, we're kind of in a different position than other people because we...
Doggy style?
Yeah.
Nice.
I see.
We live like a half block from the beach, and we've got windows coming in on two sides. So we get
talk about
nice
out of touch. I thought look at Mr. Beachfront fucking producer over here.
Well, on the beach house, you tend to get a nice breeze coming through the window.
Between the hearing the crashing of the waves here at the beach and that nice cool breeze,
right?
And just the
like he's somebody.
Very thin, flowing white fabric blowing through the windows.
Oh, yeah. All linen curtains.
Yes, linen curtains. Mm-hmm. A rattan's at the resort beach.
Right, at his own personal beach.
Right.
Yeah, our hurricane-ravaged community.
Yes, hurricane-ravaged.
But, I mean, like, if I want to take a nap in the afternoon...
You hate the cold.
But it costs a lot of money.
But that heat, I can't sleep in it. I don't mind being out in it.
It might cost less in other...
Yeah.
States. I mean, we're dealing with Con Ed and LIPA.
Yeah.
And they're not.
It's also, it's like a mental thing, though. Like, when the AC is on, it's just, you just look, it's like numbers. Just ding, ding.
Oh, you're imagining.
This month is going to be like $300.
Oh, you'll be conscious of it. That sucks.
Absolutely.
Because in the winter, the bill is going to be like $65, $70.
Yeah.
And then in July and August, it's like $325.
Holy shit.
Yeah. Can't afford that.
Yeah. No.
Can't afford that. Ain't nobody got time for that.
When I was working for a living, as they say, I was never in a place that had air conditioning. So I don't even know about, flip the air conditioning on and then worry about the bill because I never had it.
So by the time that you got air conditioning, money was no object. So it didn't matter.
No object once I got AC, which thank God for that because I would have kept it on and really gotten myself into some financial trouble.
You would have been in debt because you're not responsible with your AC unit.
I was not responsible with anything financially. And if I did have air conditioning, it would have been a big trouble. Jimmy Norton's back.
Hi, guys.
I'd have been in huge trouble.
We know how financially irresponsible you are from knowing what you bought with your credit cards.
A dinosaur. Oh, you mean now?
Back in the day.
I've gotten better, see?
No, you haven't. You can just afford it now.
I did. When I finally got a credit card that had an $8,000 limit on it, I don't know why they sent me that. The first thing I did was buy a Sea-Doo personal watercraft. and I was trying to, I think for 3 days, I was like, I'm only going to use this for emergencies.
Everybody says that.
Only right. for emergencies.
I was like, I'll just buy concert tickets, and then I'll immediately pay it back.
Yeah, yeah, I'm going to pay it back, because fuck them. I'm not paying that interest.
Right.
That's like 25% interest on this credit card.
I'm smarter than they are.
I'm smarter than
that. 10 years later, I'm paying off that Pearl Jam concert from 8 years
ago. Oh, no. Yeah, I needed a Sea-Doo personal watercraft. That was an emergency.
Right.
And a trailer. And I needed a camcorder. And I needed a new thing. It was called a carousel CD player.
Whoa.
Not DVD, mind you. CDs, compact disc, the new trend. And then I had to get CDs.
Like, to play in the CD player.
Because cassettes, get the fuck out of town.
It's like 3 days after getting the credit card when you go, well, I mean, technically, I have like $8,000 now to just use.
To use it.
And the interest, it's like, what is it, 2-4%? That's nothing.
You know what I thought about interest back then?
What?
I was interested in getting their watercraft. That's all I, even, that's the only thought I ever gave it.
You don't have the equation of, like, interest building on itself, nothing.
I couldn't fathom that stuff, or if I could, be bothered with it.
How could you think about it when the waves were crashing against you on your Sea-Doo?
When I was out there, the thought of interest or money or paying this back?
Never.
I was having too much fun.
Was it something you could afford?
No. And there were like 1,000 things in front of that I should have gotten.
Of course.
That I could have, you know, like.
I love it. It is the dumbest thing you could have bought it.
Probably the dumbest purchase ever. But let
you
me tell
air
you.
Conditioning.
When I was out on that open Long Island Sound tearing it up. You know, there's a little hatch in front.
Yeah.
I used to dump ice and some beers in there. And just fucking, every so often, I and crack that open. I'm chugging away beers and then.
Living the good life.
It was good. And then the bills would come in, and I'm like, I already got it.
Yeah.
What am I paying for something I already have? It's in my fucking driveway.
It's the same thinking as those, like, the CD clubs where it was like, you pay
yes.
a penny, you get 13 CDs.
Yeah.
And my friend used to call me and be like, you got to do this. It's the greatest scam
it's
ever.
Free CDs.
He'd go, what you do is you pick the 13 CDs,
uh-huh.
they send them to you.
Right.
And then you don't buy anything else.
Yeah. I thought that's how that worked.
And I go, that's not a scam. That's just you stealing. Like,
yeah,
of course.
Yeah, everyone did it. Yeah. And there was always that little, even as a kid, you were a lawyer. You knew it's like, they can't hold me to a contract. I'm a kid.
Yeah.
I know contractual law, and I cannot be held responsible.
Yeah.
I don't know what that was all about. They had to know people weren't paying. I personally don't know anybody that did pay. Like, how did
no,
they...
because then the CDs were like $25. You're like, why am I going to buy that CD?
Wouldn't they send you a CD of the month
to turn it, which is what they were banking on? They would then bill you like $25.
But that was also back in the day where it was like, we're just going to send you a bill. Like, it wasn't like the internet where they would just take it out of your checking account.
Right.
Yeah,
because
they have a business model where their end game was... After you got all the free shit,
then you have.
We're going to send you stuff that's really expensive and you have to pay it. Like, it should be pay for like 5 of these. Pay for 5 of them at $25 a clip. And then we'll send you 13 for a penny. You don't give it to them right off the bat and then
The best part was that there were two companies battling it out. So, like, I could get 12
Columbia
CDs
House.
From BMG and then 12 from Columbia.
Yeah,
House.
Yeah.
And then my brother could do the same thing and then all of our friends could do the same thing.
Yep.
And we've got all of our music.
Yeah. Do you know there was, before the compact disc and cassette tape, there was records.
What?
And they used to have this back in that day. And you would get this giant box of albums, full-size fucking albums.
I mean, just the shipping costs,
albums.
You would think would put them out of business.
13 albums is pretty heavy. Put 13 albums together and lift it up. You know, it's not like, but it's a lot weightier than CDs.
And it's big, too. It's 12 by 12 or whatever it is.
Yeah, yeah, big box.
Yeah.
Or 8-tracks. Send for records, albums, or 8-track cassette tapes.
Are they in business anymore?
I don't think they have that business model. yeah. What happened? what a stupid thing. I just never knew anyone that actually went through and paid
How long into that do you think before they realized that they made a horrible movie?
Yeah, like we're shipping out so many.
We've sent out 40,000. How much back? Nothing yet, but we're sure
it's anything.
Yeah, but the bills are in the mail, so.
Yeah, the bills are out there. And we do have these pennies that people taped to the right. little fucking sheet they mailed back.
Right.
The pennies.
We've made $470 in pennies here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Columbia House is still around. It's a DVD club now.
And what do they do? The thing is, I'm sure you have to sign up with a credit card.
Let's read
or
how
PayPal.
Join the Columbia House DVD Club now and get three DVDs for $2.99 each, plus shipping and processing with membership.
Oh, boy.
To get started, sign up, blah, blah, blah.
Nah. It says with membership, which means they get your credit card information.
Yeah,
how much
course.
Is processing? Yeah. $2.99 a piece plus shipping and processing.
I hate that shipping and processing.
It's not handling anymore. It's processing.
Processing. And it's more than usually the product that you're buying, especially with those infomercials. They're like, and we'll send you two. Just pay separate shipping and processing. And then it's like, wait a minute. Now the shipping is more than I'm paying for this dumb fucking thing that I'm buying that you're forcing me to buy two of.
Yeah.
Right.
That's really what they've done.
Yeah, how can it cost $30 to process a fishing lure?
Order now and we'll send you a second one. And you're like, no, what you're doing is making me buy two.
Yeah, I don't need a twat mop. It's like you can mop your floor and your twat back to back. Who needs that?
Shipping is $9 for three DVDs. So I can get three DVDs for $18. This is a great deal.
You're going to do that,
huh? Shipping and processing?
Yeah, I'm saving $51.88 right now.
Just amazing how much that...
Yeah, imagine if people still used physical media.
Terms of membership.
Terms of membership.
Yeah.
Please pay. That's a term. We'd enjoy if
we
you
expect
paid.
You to pay.
They expected you to get a check or money order, fill it out, put it in the envelope, and mail it back to them.
Yep.
Well, I
think they figured...
Yeah. The credit or debit card you provide will be used for your introductory offer and all future charges.
Exactly. They figured it out.
I think they hoped that like adults would see this in magazines and then get the bill and think, oh boy, I better pay this. I don't want this to come back on my credit score. I don't want to collection agencies. What they didn't realize was kids would just pull the thing out, tape the penny on.
Yeah.
I had one friend, and he's like, I just put my mom's name on it, and she doesn't live with us anymore. So
there you go. She's not liable for it.
Yeah.
It's amazing. It's honey, yes, the Engelbert Humperdinck CDs have just come in. Could you get my checkbook so I can write the check to these fine people that sent it? No. It's fucking 13 going to a kid who's never going to pay.
They probably knew by the order whether they were going to get their money or not.
Yes. Just Jerky Boys 1, 2, 3.
It was older people, maybe a Bee Gees, Engelbert Humperdinck.
Yeah, yeah.
Leave a shot.
They knew when they looked. They're sending them out, gathering up the CDs to put in the box. Oh, we'll never see this.
Yeah, if every single CD had a parental advisory sticker on it, they were never seeing a dime.
You ain't seeing shit. Ooh, you.
Thank you.
Happy a birthday. To you, happy birthday, dearest Jimmy.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
Yeah. Where are you leaving? I thought you were coming.
What a surprise!
No, I'm not going to Comic-Con.
Why?
Oh, no.
Because there's just a lot going on right now. People thought it would be better.
Wait, there's a lot going on?
Mm-hmm.
Where?
That's what here, you know, with Montreal.
Oh, Montreal's coming up.
And that.
Yeah, but... We're not in Montreal. We're here.
Right. Well, I mean, just the idea that I guess they maybe thought I would have a tough time handling going to San Diego and then Montreal.
When would you have gotten back?
Sunday.
What would have been hard about that?
Wait. I don't get it.
I guess it's a lot of travel for a little boy. I don't know.
Who told you that?
That's what I'm hearing through the grapevine from when they went and talked to management.
Boy, didn't Entertainment Weekly request you? Didn't the...
Oh, my God.
Yeah, the people organizing what's going on at Comic-Con requested that I go to Comic-Con. And the request was denied.
By the company?
Mm-hmm.
Because they didn't want to fly you out?
I would assume so.
There's a lot going on.
Yeah.
But what's going on that you couldn't go there?
Montreal.
I know Montreal, but that's a different week.
And then there was some talk. They were like, well, you want to go to the Gathering of the Juggalos for the show, right? And I'm like, yeah, we'll go and get audio. And they're like, well, I mean, you know, now that's kind of a lot of days.
Oh,
Wait. But it's for the show.
It's for the show. It's for audio for the
it's
show.
It's for the show.
And, like, you know, as much as I talk myself up, I think you guys can swing it without me for a few days, right?
Take you guys, two trips now you guys, and only pay for one later.
Exactly. Right. You take a trip now and the listeners pay with a good show today.
Wait a minute. But what are you going to have to do between, like, now and Sunday that there's a lot going on? Like, do you work on the weekends, like...
No, I tape my Sunday
show. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
That's not live?
No, it's
oh,
not.
Oh, man. If you just fucking broke down the wall.
Sorry about that.
I wasn't expecting to see you, because I said to Kenny, I think we got like a skeleton crew today, Opie and Iraq and Samrat.
No. Sure? Yeah, no. That was denied. It was requested that I go to Comic-Con.
Wow.
To help out everything that's going on down there.
Yeah.
And then that was denied.
But who denied it?
I think Gary.
Too much.
But didn't Gary bring it to you to begin with?
No. The people organizing it brought it to me. And then I'm like, okay, yeah, we just got to talk to Gary. It'd be fun.
Uh-huh.
And so, yeah, no, I only, as far as I know, I only talked to Rob and Gary about it, and I think that's where it ended. Or maybe they took the bladder, I don't know, but...
Wow.
Yeah, that was denied. I know it was Jason Shabiro is the guy's name who was organizing it. Because Entertainment Weekly is doing Comic-Con coverage. And instead of doing Comic-Con radio... they're just doing Entertainment Weekly, but they wanted somebody, you know, who also did Comic-Con radio there to help, you know, facilitate relationships and all that. Yeah. And Entertainment Weekly said, yeah, we would want Sam to go. And then Annabella, the talent booker, and Jason Shabiro were like, yeah, we'd like to have Sam as a host down there and to bring back stuff. And he could do a special on the Opie and Anthony channel.
Oh, boy.
That was the idea, that I come back and do like an hour.
But didn't Entertainment Weekly, like, you really liked the idea of doing a morning show there. And it would have been a good gig for you, and they just thought your voice was
shitty.
Yeah. So that's but now they're requesting you to go and do something. So maybe whatever they have going on, they're like, ah, he was good,
right?
Like, you know.
And then they realize, oh well, the content that he brings outweighs his horrendous broadcasting voice.
Right.
But that was denied.
They shut you down.
Yeah.
They're holding you back.
Yep.
That's terrible.
Yeah, that is kind of shitty.
That was denied.
Wow.
But luckily, I'm here to hold you guys up.
Well, that's good. Thank God.
Yeah.
You can just say it. You didn't want to take Jim's birthday off.
That's true.
I know
too.
What. I mean, like Opie, what? He's got his fucking beach house and Iraq's got a thing in Florida. Right.
No. I know they're here. Doing.
I know they're here.
Yeah.
I thought I saw the officer. I came in.
Oh, boy.
He's hiding.
Keep their head down.
Yeah, they're probably escorting the special guest up.
Was supposed to stay ducked behind there, but I think I saw the top of a party hat pop up. He's wearing a party hat.
Or a blowhole.
He's breaching.
Roland just texted me and said they really wanted you there at Comic-Con. Meaning the people at Comic-Con.
Yeah.
Not the people who run the channel.
Did you talk to them and go, look, this might be an opportunity for me to do something for them?
I talked to them. I explained. I lobbied for it because, you know, what am I going to do? I have to lobby for everything. But I explained, you know, I think it'd be cool. Jim's cool with it because, you know.
And Sam usually go together.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And I had mentioned it this year. I'm like, let's see if we can go to Comic-Con. And then... I have a gig tomorrow.
And I told him, I was like, you know, I was like, until the opportunity came up where the Entertainment Weekly and the people doing Comic-Con radio were like, Sam, we would like you to go. At that point, it was like, okay, well, now, if that's the scenario, then yeah, I think it'd be good to go. For the after show or the Sunday show or something.
So why was it treated like you were going on a fucking little vacation?
I don't know. I have no clue.
But this channel, but Entertainment Weekly is a channel that Scott, we didn't want them here, but I mean, you know, they apparently he really
this
wanted them,
baby.
Like their host could get away or whatever.
Oh, well, there's a lot going on.
Yeah.
Ugh.
It would have been good for me. It would have been good for the show. You know, Entertainment Weekly would realize, oh, those ONA guys are pretty good and blah, blah, blah. And
would have been bad for nobody, except someone with ears.
Yeah,
right. I mean, yeah. I can't guarantee the content, but
they're all looking. They're all looking for, you know, that crossover thing and the camaraderie of shows and whatnot. Perfect example. They shot you down for no real reason.
It was denied.
No real reason was given.
Yeah,
it's like, hey, there's a lot going on. It's very vague.
Yeah, just that's what there's a lot going on because with Montreal and the gathering coming up, which is not even sort of guaranteed, you know, Comic-Con, just really a third trip really makes it seem like a lot. I don't know, you know.
Do you think there was anything that you wouldn't have been able to do for other things in the future, all the things that are going on apparently? Do you think there was something you would miss or shirk a bit of your responsibility of because of you going to a Comic-Con?
There's no fucking way. It's never happened.
Right.
I went to WrestleMania and didn't shirk any responsibilities.
Yeah.
I would have woken up at 3 o'clock in the morning and called the show at 6 if that's what, you know, West Coast time, if that's what you guys wanted.
So what do you think the reason was that you didn't go? What do you think the real reason?
Honestly, this is my opinion.
Yeah.
I think they tend to have a poor gauge on what's going to get you guys upset. They're very worried about upset, and they have a, I don't think they have a good gauge on what.
So did they think
that's that one if you thing, went, theory of mine,
we would be like, oh, man, why the fuck did you let Sam go?
As if you don't have a staff.
They really do have a poor gauge on what's going to get us upset.
I also think money played.
And that's the
I think
other
money
thing.
Was the bigger one.
Money.
If they cared about what got us upset, yeah, we wouldn't be looking at these same
well,
floor
that's
walls.
True. Well, it's their poor gauge of what yeah, gets us upset.
They yeah, don't care about what gets us upset.
They're going, well, they'll have the smaller studio, but they'll be happy because Sam will be there.
Sam's yeah, there.
More people in the smaller studio. That's yeah, what they want.
Yeah, but I also definitely think the fact that
it's money.
Money was an
oh,
issue.
Absolutely.
They don't want to spend money on the likes of a Sam Roberts.
I mean, it could have been
in. How much is coach airfare? It's not that much. It's not astronomical.
No, it's not a crazy
no,
amount.
Would have been whatever. Coach airfare, maybe $300.
Hotel room and some food.
Yeah.
That's it.
Oh, boy. Unfucking believable.
I mean, they had a hotel room booked and everything for me. Like, they wanted me there.
When were you supposed to go?
I would have gone Wednesday, I guess.
Well,
yesterday? Wednesday. Yeah, Wednesday, I guess. Maybe after the show or something.
Oh, well, that okay, then no.
Yeah. 2 days without Sam.
Oh, see, I didn't know because yesterday, oh, see.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's silly.
That is
yeah,
silly.
Yeah, it is a little silly.
It's a very silly thing.
Unbelievable. Jimmy's back. I think we should probably, let's have warm breakfast today.
Sure, that would be nice.
That would be really nice to eat our breakfast, not fucking 20 minutes after it shows up. And then we'll come back because I want to hear, You met Sir Anthony Hopkins.
I did.
And I want to, ooh, how is he, all that stuff. And you did Leno. Amy was there, too. I want to hear about your little L.A. jaunt.
Ooh.
And it's Jimmy's birthday. So stick around for birthday festivities. No, I'll be back. Don't.
There's Opie and E-Rock coming up. I know. I know. The guys are here. Right. Long Island Beach House.
Oh, sure.
Sure.
And we will return.
It's the Opie and Anthony Show.
Holy shit. I love that. That Jimmy and the bus thing is so goddamn good.
Yeah, it was a good piece of production, too.
Oh,
why wouldn't you play Sabbath Bloody Sabbath on any day?
Well, it's Jimmy's birthday,
right,
so...
Well.
I'd probably come back with Sabbath each time. It's your day.
I like my day.
Your day.
Yes, I do.
You were out in Los Angeles.
Yeah, I just did a Leno spot. It was fun.
Ooh, yeah.
And Amy was on the show with me.
Yes.
And it was great to see Amy. She was very funny.
Was she nervous?
No, I don't think so. I mean, she might have been, but she handles it. She's been doing so much lately.
Yeah.
She's done The View. I mean, Leno, I think she did Kimmel recently. She's done everything.
She had a great little rapport with Jay and
yeah,
and with Sir Anthony Hopkins, too, who was sitting next to her.
Yeah.
It was kind of funny. She comes out and she says hi to Jay, and then she goes to take the...
Oh, why
so,
would he?
So it's kind of like... hey, Anthony Hopkins, fucking move your ass over to the couch.
Yeah.
I got to sit here. Amy's just like, hey.
It's so funny that Amy had to tell Anthony Hopkins to
yeah,
move over.
To move, like, of course.
So, Amy, I figured I could get. Let me work on Hopkins. And my manager is back there with me, and he walked in, and Jonathan goes, Anthony Hopkins is here, and he's by himself. Could take the camera behind the toilet.
Behind the toilet.
So we just walked in and knocked on his door, and I said, hey, he said, yes. And it was that it was Anthony Hopkins.
Oh, man.
And I'm like, look, I'm doing a segment on the show before you. Is it okay if we take... He's like, yeah. Movie.
Of Silence of the Lambs?
Where he's got the, he's going to eat Dr. Chilton, whatever that guy's name is.
Yes. Have an old friend for dinner.
And then after my segment, when I finished, and he was walking out, he was very friendly. He shook my hand. And what a nice guy, man.
That's cool. He's a biggie.
That's a big one. And when you leave, there was always black cars, and they get a ride to the airport or whatever.
Yeah.
And his truck was in front of my car, and he was pulled over because there's always people lined up outside by the street. And Hopkins, I could see in his car, just signing things, talking to people, and
what a nice guy.
Yeah, I was really, really happy to see that he was. You know why? Because he has nothing to prove.
No.
There's not one person in Hollywood that doesn't fucking look up to Anthony Hopkins.
Yeah.
He has nothing to fucking be a dick about.
Mm-hmm.
And he wasn't. What a great guy.
Oh, that is cool.
So it was a lovely trip.
Oh,
a lovely trip.
Yeah, a quick turnaround.
There's a lot going on. So,
you know, you can't stay there, Jimmy. We have a lot going on.
Mm-hmm. I saw on the plane checking at the airport, I see a guy, and I'm like, I know he looks familiar. And he's handing his thing in, and they say, last name, please? He says, Hansen. And it was our old pal, fucking Chris Hansen. So,
Chris Hansen.
Yeah, Hansen. So I said hello to him, and he didn't recognize my face. So I'm like, Jim from the Opie and Anthony Show. And he was very, how are those guys? And,
well.
But I realized what a fucking lousy conversationalist I am.
What?
I'm terrible.
You couldn't spark one up?
No, but it's me. It was like... He was a really nice dude, so I was like, hey, man, have you been back on since we had that, the guy who was the Opie and Anthony fan? He goes, that guy. And then I'm just standing there.
Oh, no.
I'm like, I talk for a living.
Oh, no, you couldn't come up with anything.
No, I'm really bad at that with everybody.
What kind of lighting should I use for my special?
Oh, fucking dude.
Should I use smoke?
Dude, it's just, as we're walking through, I did ask, we were going through, the security together. I'm like, why did they cancel you guys? Because, the show was great. I'm like, it was a public service. He's like, we just thought we'd move on and do other things. So I'm like, well, where are you now? Like, what are you? He's like, I'm at Dateline. Like, he's still there. Like, I didn't know.
Oh, yeah, Jimmy. They didn't cancel the show. It was a Dateline special.
Not only did
Dateline's still on.
I didn't know.
Not only were you a poor conversation with, you insulted him.
I didn't mean to.
Yeah, he's gone on to, catch...
To catch Nigerian fucking scammers.
He caught Nigerian scammers. He caught people that were scamming old ladies out of lotto tickets.
Yeah.
He's a reporter for Dateline. He doesn't just do catching pedophiles.
Got the heat that To Catch a Predator did.
Right.
But
he said we just wanted to do other things. He said we did 30 hours. I was like, oh.
Let's take a seat here.
I felt so dumb.
Yeah.
And then he was walking. He's like, you going up to the lounge? Like, he was really trying to be a good guy. But he just knew that I was a fucking bumbling weasel.
You're going up to the lounge, so take it easy.
And I'm like, yeah, I am. And I'm kind of walking behind him because he left before I did. And then we just kind of fade away, and I just peeled off and bought a New York Post. And I'm like,
Jimmy.
The reason that he stopped doing that show is because people like you who think he's just the guy who catches pedophiles.
True. He has kind of typecast himself there.
Yeah, they don't realize.
Jimmy Norton.
He's been a Dateline reporter for some time now.
Why'd they cancel you guys? Why
it's
did
not
I cancel? I know, but why did I say that?
I don't know.
Dude, I do it every time. Even when I met Hopkins, I had nothing to say to him. I'm like, I gave him the hand over the back of the hand cup. I'm like,
I'm
always extra respectful with guys like that.
Hey.
Yeah, it's such an honor. I always tell him it's an
honor to meet you. And
Anthony Hopkins.
Why'd they cancel that movie? They should do more.
Yeah. Hey, how come you can't get work anymore? Sorry.
Yeah. Silence of the Lambs?
Yeah.
Movie? How come they stopped doing that?
Why'd you quit after Silence of the Lambs? I don't know what to say to people.
Oh, Jimmy's you're a shy boy.
I'm very, very bad at that. But in here, it's very comfortable.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Like, how am I talking to you guys now so comfortably? We're all having a conversation.
Because we're all pieces of shit.
Yeah.
And they're amazingly popular, important people.
And you don't have to disguise the fact that your point of reference to them leaves you with literally zero outside information.
That's true.
Yeah, but at the same time, it's not something that you're expecting to do. Like, you're going there to get a photo with him. Or you meet somebody out in the lobby to take a photo, and then they try to have a conversation with you. like to be nice, and you don't know what to say because you're not prepared. It's I thought I was just going to take a photo with you, you know. And they're like, "So, how you doing?" And I'm like, "Good."
So let me try to put myself in that position.
Conversational.
Yeah, because you didn't have to
pleasant.
You didn't have to prepare for this.
No, I didn't.
Yeah, you just
why
talk.
Would I?
Right.
But you just come on and you chat.
And this may be news to you, but you're actually also in entertainment.
Yeah.
That's like, you're in the same.
I've seen him outside of here, and I saw him at UFC. And he was very friendly. Yeah. Really nice. And we had something to talk about. Like, when I first saw him, I congratulated him on the HBO thing. His son was with him, so he was a little subdued.
Uh-huh.
Oh, thank you. And then after, we chatted a bit about the Anderson Silva fight. So there was a thing in that moment for us to talk about.
To chat about.
Yeah. So I was comfortable talking about that. But I couldn't have gone anywhere beyond that.
You can't go any further.
Do you not box?
Are you trying to think of things that don't have anything to do with their career? Like, you don't want to say, like, to Anthony Hopkins, like, so acting, you know? Yeah, are you trying to think of, like...
No, I didn't even think of acting. It would have been nice, but I don't know what to fucking say to people.
Hey, you figure, like, hard. Everybody talks to Mike Tyson about boxing, so you want to talk about something else, and then I can't think of something
no,
else.
No, but I would have talked about boxing or whatever. Yeah. I just don't... I panic in those moments, and I've been on that end so many times.
Right.
I'm so ultra self-conscious now because I know exactly how dismissive in my mind I am over drivel.
Oh, no. Yeah, so you want to make that mark.
Like when they say, hey, I love your show, or whatever, we listen every morning.
Hey, thanks.
Thank you. It's always nice. But when they're like, dude, you get me through my days.
It's not
it does
that.
Mean something, but it's like they could just as easily say, dude, sometimes I drink decaf.
They're not making that jump beyond anybody else that, like,
right.
Could come up and say the same thing. If somebody, I guess somebody's got to talk about something a little more, not personal, but...
they have to share an experience of theirs.
Yeah.
Not I don't want to hear that, though.
But it's better than, like, when somebody goes, oh, yeah... Roland, huh? Is he really like that?
Yeah. Well, let's say, what if somebody was to come up to you, Jimmy Norton, and talk about the time they met, like, Ozzy or Sabbath, and it was interesting, like, and not just I shook Ozzy's hand, like he hung out with Sabbath for a night. Would that interest you?
I was in a hotel, not this time, but last time in LA. I'm downstairs and I'm trying to buy some gum or something. And there's a guy.
Tell us all about that.
Yeah, I don't remember what flavor, believe me.
It's something
yeah.
Light on the
why didn't you whip out?
Is it really?
Oh.
It should be a fist.
There you go.
And there's this married couple there, and the guy starts talking to me about the Sabbath thing that I videotaped. So, of course, I chatted about it. And he knew, I forget what they said that indicated to me that they knew Sharon. I don't remember what he said or what his wife said. Uh-huh. Like, oh, yeah, she's like, you know. And so we talked about 10 minutes about that and Sharon and Ozzy. And
yeah.
I never asked who they were because I'm like, I may have met them and didn't know it. So there was something there to talk. They knew what I was interested in, and they spoke about it, so I was happy to talk about it.
That's the in. That's why most people come up to me and go, guns!
Right.
Like, oh, okay. I get you.
But you don't care.
No.
No.
They think that they found something.
Better be a good goddamn gun story.
That's why it's so difficult. Like, even though you couldn't think of anything, like, you know, you've been on the other side. You know that whatever you say, they're not going to care about.
Unless you, sometimes if you ask a question, it gives them a response. Like, even though Nick Cage wanted nothing to do with me, did answer my question as honestly as he could. So if I had a good question to ask...
You could have asked, like, hey, how many times have you been on The Tonight Show? I've been on this many times.
Jimmy, he answered because he was in a seat next to you.
Anywhere.
He could not possibly go anywhere.
Oh, no, I know. But I mean, like, with Hopkins, I could have asked an acting question or a movie or something I wanted to know.
Yeah. Hey, your hair's a lot longer.
Uh-oh.
Yeah.
Than it was in Silence of the Lambs.
It was. Is that for a role?
Yeah.
Or do you just wear it like that?
Yeah, or... Are you guys doing any more Silence of the Lambses?
Movies.
Will you wait me? Right. Oh, happy
birthday. She said happy
that's
birthday.
That's it, the mashups. Exactly. That's probably where Open E-Rock are.
They're prepping. Mash up that ass.
Yeah, I'll
tell you that much.
Fuck yeah.
Fuck yeah.
Fucking mash up that ass.
She's lovely. Nicole is lovely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
She's delightful.
She does have that look. Yes.
I'm very tired.
Are you sleepy today?
Yeah, I'm very sleepy.
I don't think it was any surprise for me to say I was very sleepy yesterday. I was nodding out at the end of the show, literally.
Were you?
There were like three times my nose hit the mic. I went, poof. just literally nodding out during the show. I barely got any sleep yesterday and made it right up till the end, and then just fucking, I was like, well, and then the drive home was just a nightmare of me yelling to myself, stay awake, smacking my face, trying to drive. And then you'll go, stay awake, don't fall asleep, don't fall asleep, don't fall. What was I doing last night? I think I had this. Why? I'm almost hitting something.
Wait a minute. Hey, you've stolen the Reservoir Dogs song. And you sing.
Well, that was kind of stolen from any kiddie
That's
song.
That's first of my Cold Macaroni song.
Nah. It's kind of like
you sing that?
You are stupid. Yeah. I smack my face. I go, I
when I start singing Slap My Face, consider it done.
It's horrifying because there's really not much you can do about it. No. If you're driving and you're falling asleep. It's terrible.
Jess has been terrible. I'll get home safely and I'll pull into the garage. And then I'm like, I don't think I'm going to walk upstairs right now. And I'll put the seat back. And I'm like, let me just take a nap right here.
Are you crazy?
And I just take a nap real quick.
Hopefully with the garage door down and the car running.
In the house?
No. In the apartment building I live in. Like in the apartment garage. Just pull the seat back and get myself 10 minutes before I get out of the
car.
Can
you really sleep like that? I envy you. I can't do it. Why?
Not like sleep because I can't. Or I've had
home.
I've pulled over at a gas station halfway between here and home.
Well, that's probably smart.
Yeah, let me get 10 minutes in.
I did that when we were coming home from the Camden virus tour.
Yeah.
I had to stop on the turnpike and sleep. I was like, there's no possible way I'm making another hour.
Right.
Should have done that because it was so fucking scary. You just can't. You know what happens, too? You're so awake at one point. You're like, all right, I'm going to stay awake. I'm driving. Everything's fine. And then you fall. Your brain goes into this thought mode where you just start, you know, like you normally would. You're driving, but you think about other things. And then you realize that thought just turns into this abstract, almost dreamlike mindset where your eyes shut.
Plus,
you're asleep. You're fucking asleep, hurling down the highway with a fucking giant piece of steel.
And then the act of keeping yourself awake takes so much energy that you're like, oh,
now you're exhausted,
tired from all this yelling.
Fuck, it's so bad.
Don't fall asleep.
Yeah. Stay awake. Don't fall asleep.
Watch that be a big hit song.
I'm gonna stay awake.
I try to scare myself.
Yeah?
I just go like, and it never works because I always see it coming. Because I just yell. I go, whoa!
Like, but you know.
But I always know
it. You know it's coming.
I try, though. Because I want to get that shock of adrenaline. So I'm like, oh, give me a couple minutes. But I've never been able to scare myself.
But no, you know what else? No matter how tired you are, you're never more awake than when you almost crash because you're tired. That's that few seconds that you wake up and go, holy shit, and then you think to yourself, well, now I'm up. There's no way. I'm not even tired now.
And then 4 minutes later.
And then you're falling back asleep.
Like an asshole.
It's so scary.
People are thinking, watching Anthony in his car smack himself from about arm's length.
You know what they sometimes do?
If they're black, they're like, I wish that was me.
It's like Fight Club.
Yes.
I look at my face in the mirror and be like, okay, if I saw me right now, would I be scared? And I'm looking and like one eye is half open and I'm like, yeah, I would be. Like if I was in another car and saw me driving, I'd be like, oh, that guy should not. So I try to scare myself.
I'll like sit up like proper with like 10 and 2 thinking that like if I'm sitting up and like not
posture
like,
is the
yeah,
secret.
Yeah. Never works.
I had that recently. Like, I dropped somebody off in New Jersey and coming home, I didn't think I was going to make it. And I'm never that tired. Like, I'm my sleep is a disaster. I loved it. Like, I was scared driving. I'm like, just get home and you will. And I fucking crashed.
Oh, yeah. Immediately. You will fall asleep within a second of laying down when you're falling asleep driving.
I was watching a guy on the plane last night next to me, like, just watching people sleep. Like, I'm so envious of it. No, but I mean, like, how...
He's hovering over him, an inch away from his face.
Yeah. I was watching, and I watched how they do it. Like, I laid back, and
he puts
his hands on his chest and falls asleep. And I'm like, I can't understand what that's
God.
I'm so jealous of that.
That's torturous.
It's awful.
What, do you get the Stay Awake song stuck in your head?
Yeah, you're not going to go to sleep. Just look at this bald guy from England. You're going to see the Catch a Predator guy dozing off. You're not. Yeah, it was It's interesting to watch people fall asleep and how they, like people who could fall asleep sitting up and their head dips forward.
Yes, yes.
Like, I don't know how people sit up in an airplane and put a pillow behind their head and fall asleep.
I sleep on the subway every morning sitting up.
How do you, don't you have to hold your head up?
No, I just prop it back. I get one of the corner seats and I just fall asleep.
I could be in bed and watch TV and like at some point I'm like, all right, I got to go to sleep. And then I'll just roll over, put my head on the pillow, and within, I swear to you, within 60 seconds,
we're really lucky because
I'm
there's
asleep.
People like Jim
I know, it's,
that just can't do
believe
that.
Believe me, I think it's never great. You couldn't just go like, it's time to go to sleep.
Dude, I had
like a cat.
I had a sleep study, and even though you're all hooked up to everything, and you go, I've been sober for all these years.
Yeah, yeah.
I got a doctor prescribed one. I'm like, I have to sleep for this test to get medical result. I can't be awake.
Yeah.
And I took an Ambien supposed to knock you out for 8 hours. I took a half of one. 4 hours later, I was awake, gasping, and I could not.
Wouldn't that kind of change the sleep study?
No, I don't think so, because, you know, the same nonsense happens, I think, when you're asleep.
Oh, okay.
I don't know.
Oh, more of a apnea study than a...
Oh, yeah, it wasn't about how do I fall asleep.
All right,
that
yeah.
That would have been...
Yeah, yeah.
Sorry.
No, no.
I mean, just come in and yapped up being tired.
No, it's a big thing. I guess a lot of people have that issue.
Yeah, if I didn't have this schedule, I would never be able to sleep.
I can't wake up. Fuck going to sleep. It's terrible. I would love... I like those weekends when I can just sleep until I'm like, get out of bed. You piece of shit. You're just laying here like a lump. And then you get out of bed because you want to and you're disgusted with yourself. Anytime I'm forced to get up for things, just give, like I'm annoyed.
Oh.
It's so fucking annoying.
And you can't sleep. I can never sleep the night before and I know I gotta get up, man. It's terrible.
I'm
so glad I don't have the job that some of these fucking listeners have, these physically...
Like real job.
Yeah,
well, maybe
like,
you'd be tired then at the end of the day.
Oh, yeah, maybe.
Fall asleep.
Yeah, nothing's... nothing worse than those real jobs for getting your ass tired. I was thinking of that yesterday. Air conditioning and heating working. Because it's so hot. And these were the days where everybody would be like... Call the air conditioning company. We need air conditioning. It's hot. Like, no one in the middle of winter goes, hey, let's get some air conditioning. And then you're in an attic that isn't fucking blazing hot.
Oh, this is so nice.
Yeah. So it was always like just humping shit up into this hot insulation dust-filled attic.
You had some hot work days?
Oh, it was blazing hot. Oh.
I don't know how people do that.
It was a real job. And then everybody wants the grills that are on the ceiling, when you put in an air conditioning system, like after the house is built and it's been there for years, like you gotta put the air conditioning grills in the ceiling and stuff. And they always want them very close to the walls. You don't want one in the middle of your ceiling. You know, you want it kind of hidden against the wall, over a window, in a corner, okay. Something like that. And it sounds all well and fine until you realize up in the attic where they want it is where the roof thing is. So there's like this angle of the roof, and you only have like 4 inches to work with, and there's roofing nails poking through, so it hits you in the head.
But it's cool up there, right?
Yeah. It's a good 20 degrees cooler than the outside air. Good.
Imagine getting poked with hot roofing needles.
That's what it was.
While you were
roofing
trying to work.
In the head, blazing hot, trying to saw a hole in the ceiling from the attic down into the ceiling.
Now, wait a minute. Would the dust just go on the floor down there or no?
Yeah, you'd have to, like, put down drop cloths so the dust would be caught. And you'd have a homeowner constantly bitching, like, are you going to get that? Like, clean it up. No, I'm just going to leave it all over. At the end, you got to clean up and fucking vacuum.
Wait, so you would install central air conditioning?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
You didn't do all that shit.
Yeah, it was central air conditioning. You'd go in and cut a big hole for the big 24 by 24 return, and then you'd have to hump all the equipment up through there. Like the giant blower units have to get into the attic.
You did it by yourself?
No. I'd have like at least two other people with me.
Was it ever awkward positioning and stuff?
Oh, yeah.
With the attic crowded with shit?
Plenty of times where, you know, fucking ass in your face and you're just laying down on your back in insulation. Hot and sweaty. It's sticking to you. And then you try to wear the mask so you don't have to breathe it in. But you're sweating so bad that you wind up being waterboarded with your own sweat. Because it's like fucking the mask gets soaked.
Did your bag and ass ever get fucking sopping wet?
Terribly. Terrible sweating and just It was an awful job.
These were long days.
Yeah, it was an awful. Like, yeah, you have to. It'd be like, yeah, it's a one day in and out. You got to, when you show up in the morning, when you leave, they better be able to turn on air conditioning and be done. So you couldn't just be like, I'll finish tomorrow. So you had to get it done. I couldn't dilly-dally like I do on some of those other jobs.
Were there any times where you just couldn't get it done?
Very rare, but yeah, there was something would go wrong or yeah.
So what do? You hump? You have a bear house.
Yeah.
Because I'm so unfucking mechanical, I feel like these things just magically happen.
Yeah,
I feel like magic men do it. Literally, I couldn't be more impressed if you said I just clap my hands and then they hit a switch. It's amazing to me that you can do that. You and some guys hump this up. The first thing you got to do when you get there is go up in the attic and look and make sure you have a pathway to get this.
Right. You look in the attic. It's the blower unit itself probably weighs about 80 pounds, I guess. Okay. And then the compressor unit's really heavy.
What's the difference?
But that's the one that goes outside. That's the little fan unit that goes outside on your side of your house. And then the other unit is the one that goes in your attic, and that's the one that blows all the cold air through big ductwork, and then it branches off into smaller ones, and into smaller ones, and then goes to each grill.
So the heaviest get to the inside unit in the attic.
Yeah, that's a bitch. You got to fucking take copper tubing that you got to slide insulation on. There's two lines, one little one and one a bigger one, and then you got to tape it together, and then you got to snake it through. Give it a push. All right, hold up. And then you're twisting and yelling. It's such a pain in the ass.
Is that the worst part of the job?
No. X-insulate. Flex ductwork, which is like this accordion-like tubing that's covered with insulation. And it's you got to cut it to length. It's shards of glass that are coming out at you and going into your skin, the insulation. It's terrible.
So you cut so the first thing you do is you get up there and you put this thing in the attic.
You put all the shit up in the attic. You got to get all your shit
all
up there.
Okay.
All the equipment up there. And then you find out where the best place to put it, to put the blower unit. And then you got to put all the stuff that goes with it. The condensation pan. Because, you know, sometimes these units leak. Sure. And you don't want it leaking through the ceiling. So it sits on a giant pan with a hole in it, and the tube comes out of there and runs outside your house. So if it starts leaking, it won't leak.
What if it's an unfinished attic? Meaning, like, what if there's no... We had some boards laid down to crawl on.
They're all unfinished.
So, I mean, like, you have to crawl over these wood slats?
You're torturing yourself, but your knees are on the 2x6 beams up in the attic, the joists. So you're kneeling on them. And they're digging into your kneecaps.
And you gotta drag this thing across the top.
And you're dragging it without stepping through the fucking ceiling.
Oh, my God.
We had a couple of helpers. It happened like 3 or 4 times in my career. That fell right through the ceiling. The homeowner's like sitting there, and this fat dummy falls right through into the living room. It was classic.
Oh, no.
Yeah. And then it's like, all right, the homeowner's like freaking. We're like, don't worry, we got a carpenter that come in and they'll take care of everything. And they have to, you know, cut the big chunk that's busted up, put a new piece of sheetrock up. Sometimes it works out good. We actually had a homeowner that wanted two returns put in that were really small, and they kind of, you couldn't really get the equipment up easily through it. So we made like the guy fell through the ceiling just so we could cut a big chunk out and get the equipment up through it. It's like, don't worry, we'll fix it.
Did you fix it or someone else did?
The air conditioning company has like a carpenter on call. So they're like, oh, yeah, go over there and fix their fucking ceiling.
So once you get this thing up there, all the equipment's upstairs, do you then connect the copper tubing? Then you do the snake thing to connect the outside to the inside?
Yeah, the outside to the inside has got to be connected.
How do you make the air go to rooms?
Well, like, no, that's just for the refrigerant. So the refrigerant goes through the outside one, and it compresses it down, and it gets really cold and shit, and then it ships it up into the unit, and then it goes through a thing and cools the air.
Right.
Then to get it into the rooms, that's a whole different thing. That's the ductwork that goes on the front of the unit, the blower, and then you got to cut holes in the ductworks and branch out to each room.
So wait a minute.
It's a pain in the ass.
So there's like a giant, say, silver-colored piece of fucking
metal
that stays in the attic.
Yep.
It stays up there with a bunch of, like, octopus tentacles.
Yes,
over
octopus
different
tentacles
okay.
That run to the different rooms, and that attaches to the little box that's in the attic, And then on the underside and the ceiling of the room goes one of those grills that you see right,
right
there.
Right, okay.
And the cold air blows out. Like magic.
It's like a giant pecker with a bunch of spaghettis on it.
Or that.
That's how they do that. I thought you literally had to go down into each wall. I don't know what I'm talking
Sometimes
about.
Sometimes you do. Some homeowners want it in the walls, and that's a much more
as opposed to where?
As opposed to in the ceiling. They want it on the wall. So you got to find, you know, in between the beams and cut out a piece of the wall and put this oval kind of duct in there. And it's not fun work.
How long would it take you to do an average house?
A full day.
Okay, 8 hours.
Probably, over eight, maybe 10 hours.
Wow.
10 hours, yeah. It's just, it's real work. It sucked. I never wanted to do it. I always wanted to get out of it somehow and figure out a way to get out of doing that for the rest of my life.
So so the air works that night, or does it take a day or two to get going, or does it just work?
No, it worked. You flip this, hopefully, you flip the switch on the thermostat, and cold air comes out, and you go, ooh, yay, it works.
Did you ever have it where you did that and nothing happened?
Yeah, yeah.
How disappointed were they? Can you think of a worse thing?
Get ready, here it comes.
The unit's no good.
Click, nothing.
Oh, your mother's cunt.
then you got to start troubleshooting.
Would you do it right there or the next day?
And electronics, the thermostat and stuff. But if it was a mechanical problem, like, you know, air is blowing out into the attic through a hole in the duct that wasn't taken care of, then I'd have to get up there. But for the most
part...
What do
you mean a hole in the duct that you didn't take care of?
Like, you know...
That tubing. You brought the duct tubing.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, okay.
Nothing worse though than turning it on, though, and nothing. Yeah. Like, oh, boy. The homeowner's sitting there getting all ready. He's got a glass of iced tea. He's just looking at the thermostat, looking at you.
And all he wants is we're just built with little units.
The thermostat. Yeah, yeah. You put the thermostat in the wall.
Then how do you get the fucking wires up to the machine?
Yeah, you got to drill a hole in the plate up in the attic, and then you snake the wire down, and then you drill a hole where you want the thermostat, and then you put a little wire in there and grab the wire and pull it through the hole. And you attach it to the thermostat and screw it to the wall.
Was that what's the best part where you knew, like, we're home free?
That was pretty good, the thermostat part.
Wouldn't you test it before you put it in the wall?
No. No, you just fucking hook it up, let it rip. But, yeah, it was that part. Yeah, when you started knowing, you know, you're cleaning up, it was pretty good.
Guys falling through the ceiling makes me
laugh. The guy falling through the ceiling. And it was great if you would see it happen because you'd be downstairs. And you'd hear like this, boom, boom. And then you'd just see one leg, boom. Like a leg would be sticking out of the ceiling of the living room. It's the fucking leg.
Did anyone ever fall all the way through or no?
Yeah, we've had people fall completely through. It's almost harder, though, to fall all the way through because the joists aren't very, like, close together or far apart.
Yeah.
They're pretty close together, so it's not that
bad. They would always catch themselves or something, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
That's fucking funny, man. What if, can you do that for a living?
No, hilarious. No. I mean, I couldn't be. I was a stock boy at a furniture store, so I had to unload a truck for a while.
Yeah.
And even that, like, one summer of that, and it was enough.
Yeah, it's just...
And that was, I mean, I was in a big garage and I was unloading stuff, you know, I was lifting stuff, but it wasn't being cramped up in an attic. We were watching guys roofing last weekend at some like shopping center.
Yeah.
And it was like 100 degrees outside. Gross. And they were, you know, putting down the roof slates and like up on top of the, I was like, oh, that's got to be horrible.
We did that too, where it was in commercial jobs, like big buildings, commercial work, you'd be on the rooftop and you'd have to cut a giant hole, like 6 foot by 6 foot hole in the roof.
Would you ever get thirsty?
Oh, it's always thirsty.
You just wanted a glass of water.
Have we ever in one of those hot attics and you had to take, and I drank too much last night shit?
Every night or every day I'd be in there. Every day.
You have to shit.
Oh.
Would you pass gas
and
up
the
there?
The homeowner doesn't want you shitting in their fucking...
No,
they don't
can't.
Want you drinking out of their fucking glasses or anything.
They didn't want you
shitting in their toilet. You are the scourge of society. Hence the spackle bucket. You'd have to shit in like a spackle bucket like an animal.
Where?
Sometimes in your work van.
You go in the van and shit in the bucket?
In the back of the work van. And just shit in a spackle bucket.
But not like in their attic.
No.
Why wouldn't you just tell them I got to use your restroom? Yeah.
The company did not want you using their restrooms.
No, they would piss either?
They'd prefer...
To piss, yeah.
But the company wanted you to, like animals, go into the back of the van and shit in a spackle bucket?
Yeah, I'd have to throw like all the tools and equipment to one side so there'd be enough room to pop the spackle bucket in, shut the van doors, and just reek out the van.
Would there be toilet paper in the van?
Yeah. You'd usually keep
Would everyone shit in the
paper.
Same bucket?
No. You'd get your own personal bucket.
I don't know why our air conditioning's not done yet. He's been in the van for 20 minutes.
Yeah, what's he doing in there?
Would it stink in the van?
Oh! Then you'd have to drive home?
Horrible.
Would you have to tell your coworkers I'm going to drop a deuce in the van?
Well, you wouldn't drop one right before you left. And you'd open the doors up and let it air out, but still, it's
Where would you leave the bucket until you went home?
Well, you'd have to seal the bucket up and leave it, you know, either outside the van.
So now would one guy take all three buckets off, or would you each carry your own shit bucket, like your little A on a bucket of duty?
You would just have the buckets in the truck, and then you'd throw them away. Stack of buckets are a dime a dozen.
Walking by in these neighborhoods, and there would just be a bucket of shit just sitting
You wouldn't
outside.
Know it. You know, when you see a work van near your house, someone could be shitting in it right then and there. Give a little knock.
That's all I'm going to think about.
I know that someone's taking a big dump.
If this van's a rockin', I'm taking a shit.
I'm taking a dump. Yeah. Yeah. The commercial jobs are worse because it was just a bunch of animals.
6 foot by 6 foot hole.
Yeah, you'd have to cut like where the people downstairs would look up and see a giant hole in their roof. Just a big hole in the roof. So then you really had to get the thing taken care of because if it rained, you know, your fucking water, it's going to pour in their building.
So what went over the roof hole?
It was a platform that these big air conditioning units sat on. And you'd put it on the roof, and then you had to tar it in. So you had to sit there with tar and tar paper and wouldn't leak when it rained. So and you believe me, one, like, a marble-sized bit of tar would spread over you like it was a gallon. That shit will be everywhere. It's murder.
So how many days does it take to do that process?
That's probably a couple of days. But once you put a hole in the roof, you got to make sure it's weather-tight. Before you leave.
So the base goes over...
The base goes over the hole, you screw it down to the roof, and then you start waterproofing with tar.
And the base has something in it that the unit can go on top of.
Yeah, it's just like a square base that the unit then, they bring a big crane and lift it up and...
So how come it wouldn't fall through the hole in the roof? Oh, it's straddling the hole?
Yeah, it's straddling the base that you put on. You put it like it's a base made just for that unit.
And when you're doing
and
a commercial...
pop it on.
When you're doing a commercial job, there is nobody like a homeowner or something to say, can I get you a glass of water?
No, that you got to fucking bring your own shit.
And your own buckets to shit in.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then what a joy when the coffee truck shows up. So that's where you get your lunch and everything. The fucking roach coach, they'd call it.
Oh, you're telling me you go down there, you get more roaches than coffee.
Get your cup of coffee. All the trades out there by the truck just talking to each other.
Right.
It was not my life. I hated it. I don't want to hear about the carpenter and his fucking... kids and his new car and his wife giving him shit. Everybody there was regular Joe. They were real regular Joes.
Would you ever have a day where you were in this fucking hot attic or on this fucking cocksucker roof and then go home and your wife was cunty?
Yes. Yes. All the time. That bitch.
You have tar on your pants?
Yes. That's what I needed. Her being fucking cunty to me. Covered in tar. What the fuck? Take out the garbage. Oh, sorry, dear.
Oh.
I was just being fucking assaulted in an attic.
You'd have to go home and do chores?
Chores.
Ugh.
Yeah, I had a few chores to do. Clean out the cat box. I'm not the one that wanted four cats, you cunt.
Did you ever say that?
No. Yes, dear. Okay, where's the scooper? That was me. Yes, dear, where's the scooper?
You were a duty scooper?
I was duty scooper and garbage taker outer.
Spending the day in attics and on roofs, and then you go home and bend over and scoop kitty litter?
Scoop cat shit out of a box.
What a horrible life you had.
It was an awful little fucking
existence.
Opie
really saved you from a life of fucking just terribleness.
Oh, I was doing like some shit for the morning show at one point, for the morning show at BAB. So I'd go in for like an hour before I even had to go to work. And then I would go to work, and I'd be in an attic and shit, and it was awful, and I'd be yelling and getting cut and shit. And then I'd have the radio on, and I'd hear, like, one of my bits is on the radio. And I'm like, how does this, like, it didn't seem possible to me. If I'm on the radio, I must be rich and famous.
Oh, you didn't understand why show business. This is,
I'm in show business. Why am I still doing this? And then I got the big call, you know, the big call. I got called up to the big leagues of radio. And I was a good boy. I gave my 2 weeks' notice.
Oh, you did.
Like a good worker.
But this whole life explains why now you're so unapologetic.
Yeah, I am.
About being stinking rich.
I could give a fuck if anybody has a problem with what I do.
Yeah,
my cash.
A lot of people don't know that Anthony really, this is what came from fucking nothing. Oh,
it was terrible. Terrible. I gave my 2 weeks' notice. I was working at, what was that?
Apollo.
The last job I did for Apollo was at a hospital in Smithtown. It was St. John's or something like that. And I gave my 2 weeks' notice, and that lasted 3 days. Oh. 3 days in, I was doing something, and I went to screw something in, and I cut my hand. And I looked at it, I fucking grabbed my hand, I grabbed what I was screwing in, I threw it on the floor, I went, that's it! Take it easy, everybody!
You left in the middle of the job?
In the middle of the job. I fucking walked. I said, I'm done. What am I trying to be noble and give 2 weeks' notice so they could find some other skilled, intelligent man to replace me? Stop. Go to any fucking bus stop, you'll find somebody that can replace me.
But that's the fantasy of every guy that has that job.
Take this job and shove it.
Yes.
Is that the greatest feeling that there ever has been?
It was amazing. I threw that thing down. I walked off the job knowing that I was going to a radio job.
Joining Opie in Long Island.
This was the big break.
We have our show in Boston signed.
We have it. We have a start date.
So
I gave my 2 weeks' notice.
You're working...
Oh, yes.
Wow.
I was working air conditioning.
So it wasn't like when you just start a little bit, like you hear a bit. Now, you were on the radio slash installing air conditioning units.
I had to pay the bills, you know?
Wow.
I had to pay for that jet ski.
Yeah.
I'm going to be back in an attic, cutting fucking air conditioning duct, looking at my partner or something there, and going like, you know, I used to do radio. I was you ever the Opie and Anthony show, WAF? Yeah, that was me. Yeah, yeah. Pass me the 8-inch flex duct and the duct tape, please. Oh yeah, it was fun. It was great. Oh,
you were dreading that.
I thought there's no other thing. I'm going to be going back to sheet metal.
How long were you guys laid off? Like out of work for?
From April Fools.
Right.
April Fools.
Yes. I did a prank like that once.
No, you didn't.
I did. I said, the mayor left his hat in Arby's. Apple Falls.
Did you get in trouble?
Yes.
the mayor left his hat in Arby's. Yeah, a big scandal. We had a gig by... Shit, when the fuck was it? It wasn't very long.
No.
It was only a couple of months.
Oh, a couple of months?
Yeah.
So you had some time where you were panicking.
Right away, I was panicking. Opie kept saying, he goes, don't worry. We'll fucking get another gig. It's not even an issue.
And you were like, what the fuck did you do to us?
Oh, my God, we're so fucked.
Yeah.
We're so fucked. Oh, my God, I got to buy new tools. I got to buy new sheet metal tools. I threw mine out on 95 driving up to Boston.
Did you?
Yes. Right out on the side of the fucking road. You might still be able to find them. I did. I just took them and went, flang, clang, clang, clang.
You're such a theatrical guy.
He really is.
It was very cathartic.
You have to quit in the middle of the job. You have to throw your tools out the window.
Yeah. I did.
What do you think? I bet you fucking dummy thought that's how the fucking movie credits would roll.
Of course.
doors.
With the shot of the van driving, the Scooby-Doo van, while his tools fucking still
clang,
flying.
Clang. Yes. Roll just, credits.
Meanwhile, you got to back up down the highway and pick him up again.
Pick him up. Fuck. We're fired. How embarrassing.
Picturing the opening to his fish out of water sitcom.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
Oh,
that would
God.
Be a good sitcom, though. A radio guy now redoing. Where do you go with that sitcom?
Yeah, where does
Who
it
cares?
Go from there?
After episode one, he hangs himself. He hangs himself in the pilot.
I would have. Oh, my God. I don't know what I would have done. Oh, my God. And considering the fact guy. I was still with the wife, so I wouldn't have. Yeah.
You'd have kids by now.
Oh,
can you imagine you had a baby by now?
And fucking working back at Apollo. So what happened there, Mr. Showbiz? They would have all goofed on me.
All the time.
Hey.
They'd play your bits. When you walked in the room, they'd play one of your bits.
Remember this?
Imagine if you knocked her up, and in that first month that you were off the radio, she made you quit to take care of the baby.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. Oh, no. I couldn't.
And then Opie couldn't even look anymore with you because you were simply out of it.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Imagine if that fucking big horse dick had been pumping fucking anything but blanks.
I was fucking pulling that out. Oh, Jimmy.
That wasn't me.
That wasn't me. That was, it's a birthday one.
That was me pushing out the years.
A birthday toot.
Speaking of,
yeah, we'll take a break.
Adam Carolla's coming in first time on the show.
Yeah, yeah. So we'll take a break, and hopefully he'll be here, and we'll come back with Adam Carolla after the halt.
The Opie and Anthony Show.
Oh, get
Ooh.
Up. Oh, a little kiss.
Ooh.
Get down.
Okay. How we doing? This song just makes me feel like I'm fucking 8 years old again.
Yeah? Like, feels like someone's dicking you in the ass?
No, that could be 25.
Who's Adam?
Adam Carolla is here.
We've never had on the show before. I'm happy he's coming in.
There we go. Adam! There he is. How you doing, man?
Pleasure. Good to see you.
What's up? Good to see you, brother.
Take a seat right over there. Pull up a mic. Why not, huh?
Oh, God.
L.A. time, huh?
Yeah, well, then I did Artie's show. I did Caroline's last night.
Right,
and then I went straight to Artie's show.
Oh,
so,
man, you're exhausted.
We left L.A., you know, got picked up at 5:30, so it was one of those.
How was Artie?
Crazy. Artie's great.
Yeah.
You know, Artie's...
I'm fucking going on, and, you know, we're plugging together tonight.
Dave's coming. I think Dave's doing Caroline's tonight, or maybe tomorrow night.
Well, you just do one. What do you get in that one night for a club?
No, I'd with that. But if I'm doing the podcast, it's like do a club.
Uh-huh.
Do like multiple shows.
Last time I might have seen you once since then, but the last time was we did the live Caroline's podcast, and Justin Bieber walked out halfway through the show.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know what he's doing, period. It's pretty funny to watch the self-destruction of a teen idol.
Well, also, like, these guys start picking up tattoos.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
They pick them up pretty quick.
Yeah.
And so you're 19, so, like,
no room for any more life experiences to put on your body.
Right.
Yeah, very odd.
Either that or he will just stop doing it. It's really, it's embarrassing because he's going through this, you know, you're 18, 19, we're all kind of jizz buckets. And just to watch him humiliating himself, and it's like, it probably is something nobody would want filmed by the whole fucking planet.
I was kind of a jizz boda back. I wasn't, you had to squeeze me a little bit. It's not like you kicked me, jizz would come out. You have to put a little pressure, and then I would squirt out. But more jizz boda back.
Well, yeah, I was more of a jizz bucket. Like, if you just looked at me, it was overflowing.
That's a good point.
Melodrama.
You wouldn't want everybody to look in on your fucking 18, 19-year-old thing. You just, maybe not a full jizz bucket, but we were pretty jizzy back then.
Speaking of jizz bucket and Jim, you know, I met your parents backstage at the Borgata.
Were you working with Jay?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
I wasn't working with him. Jay's just such a mensch. I was playing the Borgata. He was playing the Borgata. He called me and just went, "Hey, at the Borgata." I said, "Yeah." He said, "You want to catch a ride?" I said, "Catch a ride?" to the airport? Like, I'm such an idiot, you know? You're going to drive me to Philly? So you're going to drive me to Philly tomorrow? Because I got a Southwest flight back to L.A. No, nah, we leave tonight. We drive to the airport tonight? No, you catch me, I got a plane. You know, I was like, oh, you got a plane? Oh, you're a ride on your plane. Yeah. This is awesome.
Nice.
And he said he flies in to Atlantic City.
Yeah.
From Van Nuys to Atlantic City.
Wow.
Flies in that day.
That
gets in it. Gets
awesome.
In at 6:30. He doesn't go to his room. He just goes to his dressing room. So he goes from the airport to his dressing room, like everyone else upstairs. You know, squeeze one off, quick shower, not in that order. You know, lay out, take a nap, and then go do the show. You know, he goes right to his dressing room, and he'll just hang out in his denim socks and denim contact lenses, denim breathe right. He has a denim breathe right, honestly. If you see him off stage, and he'll sit there. And I'll hang there for, like, you know, an hour and 20 minutes eating a little fruit. And then I'll go do a show, and then it's right back on the plane. He never goes upstairs.
Wow.
He never goes to his room. So
he's Mr. Showbiz.
Yeah, he said, just come on over. Just drop your stuff in my room. And then when you're done with your show, we'll just take off. And I went to his room, and he was standing there with your kindly elderly parents.
Yeah.
And they're like, we're big fans, and they're out of a Rockwell painting. And you're from the band Rockwell. And they're like I'm the whole time I want to go, you know what your son's up to? You know what he's you have
they're
any
more
clue?
Than aware, I think.
Are they? Yeah. All right.
Yeah. Horrified.
Yeah, they are nice normal.
You'd
people.
Never know it. You would never know it now.
The lovely yeah, the lovely Nortons. Oh, we have a fun. It is Jimmy Norton's birthday, and we have.
I know. I saw a guy with a cake.
We do have some phone calls coming in, so if we could take this call. Hello, hello. Who is this?
What's the date of your docuseries? Hello.
Hello. Someone want to wish Jimmy Norton a happy birthday?
Hey, Norton.
Yes.
I'm looking for Jimmy Norton. Is he around?
Yes.
Oh yeah.
All right.
Who's this?
He doesn't even know who this is.
This is Mike Tyson.
Oh, hey, Mike. How are you?
What's going on, buddy?
I was just talking about you before and how good it was to see you at UFC.
Wasn't that pretty awesome?
It was a really upsetting loss to watch.
Man, I just thought it was unbelievable. I can't believe they were fighting that guy like that.
Yeah, it's like he got, friend, when we're talking about the Anderson Silva fight, and he got cocky. Anderson Silva got cocky, and when he first got stunned, when that punch got thrown, did you think he was faking that he was wobbling, or did you think that he actually got tagged?
Well, I really think he got tagged a little bit, and it hurt, but it didn't hurt that bad, but he was hurt a little bit. Question what that's all about.
And why has nobody been able to do that to him? It was like, because it seemed like when he got hit, Silva just went back better than anybody I've ever seen. And it seems like Weidman just stepped into it and threw the next
punch. Guys rise to the occasion. They make all the other opponents better fighters. They have to rise to the occasion. And sometimes when things like that happen, the greatest fighter, he slacks down a little bit because he's...
Mike, this is Adam Carolla. Remember when I came to your house?
Adam, what's up, brother? I just came to holler and give Jimmy Norton the big birthday love. How you doing?
Good. I went to Mike's house.
What's
that? Was my pool fixed yet, or were they still working?
They were still working on your pool.
Yeah, okay.
That pool was 73% to 81% done. I mean, I got to check my notes. But, yeah.
It's pretty good now, man. So when you come over now, we can take a dump, you know?
I'm bringing my trunks, but I'm keeping my shirt on. I don't want to be embarrassed.
No way, man. No way. We're going to give you those testosterone shots.
Yeah, I've yet to be invited to the Tyson compound in Henderson. I hope when I'm out there, I get to come take a dip.
Yeah.
Welcome. You know that.
Oh, there you go, Jimmy. That's an invite.
You know that big Jim knows he got mad love.
Now he's got a bridge with like a koi pond.
Oh, really? Wow.
Like, yeah. Damn. Yeah, you know you've arrived when you have a semi-moat. Yes.
No. That's the ashes and remnants of Mike Tyson when he had money. It's getting old. We have to rebuild.
Rebuild?
Well, he had people walking around and cleaning and doing things like that. Kids running around.
Those are numbers of my family.
Oh, really? Jeez, you're sure rude.
Hey, a place like that, do you design it, or does your wife design it, or do you have designers and just say just whatever you guys want to do and make it look nice?
Well, you know, at first it was my my love's laboratory at one time, but then I got married, and she put the woman marriage touch on it, and I don't even know what place I live in anymore.
Oh, man.
She just took over?
Yeah, it took over the whole Lust Laboratory.
The Lust Laboratory.
The Lust Lab.
That sounds...
It's nice to know it happens to all of us. It doesn't matter how masculine you are, right, who you are, that when you fall in love, they just fucking take over. Yeah. It's nice to know it happens to even guys like Mike.
Hey, listen, man, listen, we don't know anything about this masculinity thing. We just know it's supposed to define us as men.
Right.
You know, but we don't know where it comes from. We don't know anything about it. And if we didn't call it masculinity, what would we call it?
Be whipped?
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yes.
And Mike, someone was just telling me your one-man show was really good. And it wasn't because they knew you were calling in. They just brought it up.
Hey,
As James here. Buster Douglas used to say, apropos of nothing. That was his thing.
Tell me about that word again.
Apropos of nothing. Or maybe that was Ronaldo Snipes. I can't remember which heavyweight from the 80s would use that one.
Apple-Poe or Apple-Bee? Which one is it? Apple-Poe, Apple-Bee.
If I slow down, I'll fuck it up. So I have to just, it's one of those names you have to blow through it. Like an NBA player that's from Kazakhstan, you know?
Tell me about it. Kazakhstan's kicking a lot of the guy from boxing from Kazakhstan is kicking everybody's ass.
Oh, yeah.
Gorky something?
Yeah, middle name. Middleweight, yeah.
Yeah.
Gorky.
Yeah, those guys just need to pick up like sugar or something, like in their middle name. Yeah, this guy's knocking out everyone, destroying everyone, and the problem is I've talked to boxing analysts about this guy, and they're like, yeah, that Russian kid's pretty good. No one can say the guy's name.
Yeah.
I can't even. I'm from the Gorky Park. I'm just, Gorky.
Gorky.
No, it's he's the Manu Ginobili of middleweights.
Ginobili?
No, but it's one of, that's the whole point. We can't figure this. Someone go online, you'll figure out the guy's name. He's
everybody
the most.
Knows, kicking everybody's ass right now. Everybody knows that.
He's the most dominant guy in boxing right now, but no one can pronounce his name.
Is he like fucking Drago from Rocky?
Hey, what are you
talking about? I'm talking about dominant way he's hurting people.
Middleweight, yeah.
How he's stopping them and the referee's stopping the fight. He's really hurting people.
Body shots.
Hey, when are you shooting, Mike? I know you're shooting in New York. When are you actually filming? Oh, did you film already?
We just filmed. Last night was our last night.
HBO
show.
That's going to be huge.
I was in Los Angeles last night.
For HBO. Huh?
How'd it go?
It went wonderful for the one-man show, Let's Be the Truth, and I think HBO is going to air it.
Yeah, it's going to be
huge. Of course they will. That's fantastic, man.
Mike's, I saw Mike like 3 or 4 years ago. He was heavy. He was depressed. He was shuffling. Like, was, you know, like the old boxer shuffle, and he looked like an old blues singer.
I was singing some old blues back then.
In light and in great shape. Like, it was absolutely an amazing transformation.
Yeah.
Well, I wanted to live. I got tired of wanting to die, and I wanted to live because I was trying to die, but it just didn't work. So let's try this living stuff again and see what happens. Talk about my peers and people who do the same thing I do, as you know, occupation, because they know the difficulty of it. And that's what I appreciate more than anything. People, my peers, understand the difficulty of it and still see that I achieved.
So saw
some of the filming from the HBO, and... Oh, man, it looks so much different. It looks beautiful.
See how
you like it, yeah.
Yeah, I never saw it in that kind of footage before.
Well, I mean, it means a lot.
Hey, man, listen, man, I really appreciate you during the time of need when we were first started promoting this show, and you were behind it 100%, and I knew just by the way you were pushing it, it was more than just a job, and I really appreciated that, you know.
No problem, man.
For you, Jim. Don't ever hesitate to ask, man. I really respect you as a human being.
That's a nice guy to have.
Thanks, Mike.
On your side.
Oh, you guys know I got a boxing promotion, right? Mike Tyson Productions.
Oh, no.
I ain't Mike Productions. And I got, I'm going to be fighting the ESPN 2 Friday Night Fight. And I'm going to have introduced my junior lightweight champion, Mendez. And it's going to be a really, really interesting fight.
Look forward to seeing that. There it is.
When is that? When?
Iron Mike Productions.
It'll be August 23rd.
Oh, okay. You know, it's fun.
I'm launching ESPN 2.
You have a good clothing line, too. I like the Tyson clothes. And I bought one at the Undisputed Truth the first time, and it was an XL, and I lost weight. Now I can't find it in medium or small. It was like a picture of your face on it. It's fucking... The clothes are great. The shirts are...
Jimmy's problems these days.
Yeah, I've lost some weight. The clothing line is great.
He can breathe better. Oh, man, right? He can breathe better. He really sucks now.
I just Googled in Iron Mike Productions, and there was just Mike Ditka getting a hip replacement. So I don't know if there's more you could give us on that. I can't find it here. Oh, no, there it is. There it is.
Yeah. Okay.
No, I got it.
Well, if you want to come in before and promote, if you're in town and you want to come by, man, whenever you want to come, it's an open door.
Thank you. I mean, it's going to be my pleasure, brother. Great. Thank you.
Iron Mike Tyson.
Thank you, buddy.
For your birthday wish to Jimmy.
Hey, I'm bringing my trunks and my water wings, and I'll see you soon.
Take it easy, man.
Take care, Mike.
Bye.
That's the champ, Iron Mike Tyson.
Yeah, it's funny, when I first heard the voice, I thought it sounds like Tyson, but I'm like, it can't be Tyson. Like, you know,
here's how you know everyone is the person. If it sounds like Tyson, but not enough like Tyson, the guys are doing Tyson impersonations, right. Say indubitably, and they work. Like they expend energy, they push. And they say they buzz. They have their three or four buzzwords.
Yeah, the buzzwords.
And that, then they're doing Tyson. Right.
And so, he sounded like it was just talking, casual conversation.
Yes. And now I got to find this guy's name. I got to tell your guy.
Is he Russian or?
Yeah, he's Russian, but you know, not Russian. One of the fucked up republics around. Yeah, I don't. By the way, when I grew up, there was just Russia.
There was Russia.
And then Egypt was like Arabian Nights, like a size of a camel, you know, and a guy with a turban and a flying carpet and stuff. What the fuck is going on?
Now everything's fucking divvied up into separate little
and
things.
And they're all fighting, and you never heard of any of these stands and everything. And the guy's Russian, but he's darker than a Kenyan, and you're like, what the fuck? And he's declared a fatwa, and you're like, what?
But no. You're Russian.
Yeah.
You're Russian.
By the way, I hope you're not sending any brides out from this neck of the woods, because my idea of a Russian bride is, you know, completely different than this.
We're trying to talk to Adam. I want to ask you so many things about your show and your stance on a lot of things, which are
sure.
I agree with wholeheartedly. But we have another call here for Jimmy's birthday.
Dwayne Bobick is calling in.
Hello.
How's it going, man?
Hello. How are you?
I'm good. It's Chuck Liddell.
Oh, hey, what's up, Chuck? How are you?
Chuck Liddell. You were close.
You doing, Chuck, remember when I was at your house and we were swimming?
Adam Carolla's here with us, too.
Is your hot tub done yet, Chuck?
Yeah, actually it is.
It's fine. They're only getting... Mike Tyson just called. They're only getting guys that can fucking pulverize me to call in on my birthday.
All right, what girl is calling next?
I know. Hopefully Rhonda.
Yeah.
Last time I saw Chuck was also at that UFC fight. And were you shocked by it? Because a lot of the fighters had picked Weidman to beat Silva.
Yeah, you know, I was shocked by it. I mean, I thought, it's one of those things. You know, he just kept going and going and with that taunt and stuff. And, I mean, it's dangerous, man. You keep playing like that, eventually you're going to get caught.
Have you ever had anybody do that to you, like where they got in your – did Rashad ever do that or any of those guys? Because Silva at the end said he didn't want to fight again. He didn't want to rematch. And now, of course, they're doing it. But you've taken losses. How awful is it if you're taunting somebody to wake up on the floor? I mean, that, for a guy like that, that's got to be really embarrassing.
And I think, you know, him talking after the fight, I mean, he just got knocked out. I mean, I'm sure all his senses weren't there when he was talking. He was, you know, letting him interview.
When you wake up on the floor, like, what goes through your mind? Like,
Well, I try to wonder what I was drinking first. And, oh, that's right.
Like, do you remember getting hit when you get knocked out, or do you just all of a sudden, like...
Not before you actually got knocked out.
It rewinds.
You know, it rewinds a little bit. You know, I have to go back and look and see to watch the fight. So.
Oh, when it was your fight, you'd have to go back and watch it.
Yeah, I have to go back and watch it. I mean, I don't remember what. I mean,
it's got to suck to watch.
I think in the Franklin fight, the last thing I remember was that I hit that shot and I hit that headbutt that opened my head.
That was a heartbreaker to watch because you were beating him pretty well. You had thrown kicks, which I hadn't seen you throw kicks in a while, and he just, you know, he just you got it a little too close, and he just, that fucking, wasn't his left hand broken or something?
Yeah, it was one of those things. I got in great shape for that fight. I had extended my training camp was probably about 6 months with the Ultimate Fighter show and everything, and you know, I started saying, you know, I decided if I'm gonna come back again, I'm gonna throw my kicks again. I'd had problems with my knees, so I wasn't throwing them much. But I said, screw it, I'm going to throw them. And you know, things are going great, and it, you know, just got caught.
Well, I appreciate you calling me, man. I know you're busy, and you got a life, Chuck. And you get fucking children and a wife. But I appreciate it, man. You're a great dude, and I look forward to seeing you again, man.
Thanks, Chuck.
Well, happy birthday, bro.
I'll see you soon, man. Thanks, Chuck.
Yeah, just look at that. Everyone loves Jimmy.
What a nice dude.
Everyone loves the Jimmy.
All those guys that can fucking, those are the guys that don't have the complexes. Guys like Liddell, Mike Tyson, they just treat people nicely because they could fucking throw you through a wall. They have nothing to prove.
Yeah, that's big dog versus a little yappy.
Yeah.
You know, nipping.
Exactly.
By the way, the guy's name is Gennady Golovkin.
Golovkin.
Gennady Golovkin. I mean, and when you read it, you can't. Gennady Golovkin is the best pound for pound guy in the world, but no one.
It's Gennady.
That's the point.
I just made it up. I don't know.
Yeah, I
wanted to see how confident he was in his pronunciation.
Yeah, you can't say it. So no. He doesn't, you know, he doesn't get as much
doesn't roll
press.
Off the
right.
Do you watch a lot of boxing? I don't watch it anymore after UFC. Like, I can't, like, guys like Tyson and all those guys that, like, excited you because they're who they were. Like, I can't find any boxers I really connect with. Maybe Mayweather's the only one.
It's a little like once you discovered hardcore porn, going back to sort of Skinamax, like, hey, silk stockings.
Right.
It's always some side boob. I wonder if they're really doing it. Yeah. It's a little of that.
Yes.
But any port in a storm, you know, but still that. You're looking for your next UFC fight.
Mm-hmm.
Do you watch them or no?
Yeah.
You do? Oh, okay, so you don't understand what's going on. It's really hard to get back into boxing. I want to because there's enough
fighters. Well, you know what it is? It's become a business. The thing about boxing is the heavyweight division is that's the jewel in the crown of boxing. And the heavyweight division has been dominated by two Russian-German guys who play chess and have doctorates. And they're in business to make money but not to lose brain cells.
Right.
You know, back in the day, these guys would just trade. Their business was getting hit and hitting other people. You know, Joe Frazier was going to go at it with Jimmy Ellis. Sorry.
That'd be a good one.
I've been hitting the head, too.
Yeah.
Jimmy Ellis and guys like that. And that's all they did. There's 15 knockdowns in the first four rounds, you know, if you see that, like George Foreman and Jimmy Ellis and guys like that. And now it's a business.
Yeah.
Like, literally, the guy's like, I need to knock the guy out or just win the fight, but I need not to get punched in the process. And so they go out there with their condor-like wingspans and their crazy technique. And then also, they don't, the Klitschko's the nicest guys in the world, but they don't have that street pride. You know what I mean? Like, you hit me, I'm going to hit you harder. You know, it's like Mitch Blood Green
and Tyson
going after it. It's just lots of jabs, lots of discipline. And it makes for a super boring heavyweight fight.
Right. Yeah.
You want to see them just like windmilling each other.
Yeah. You want that, you know, bad blood.
Yep.
This guy's, you know, on an online chess tournament later that night. Just got to keep his wits about him.
Just a gentleman, a real gentleman.
Yes. Yeah. And so he's just up there staying out of trouble. Technical. Nobody's been able to get near these guys for, you know, 5 years.
You know what I watched the other night just to do it? Sometimes I'll go on and watch these old boxing. I watched fucking George Foreman against Ron Lyle.
Ron Lyle.
I had to reread it. I couldn't believe it. I was like, this has got to be a misprint. And I watched the stare down, and I'm like, what a tough motherfucker. And they said he wasn't afraid of Foreman. He wasn't afraid of anybody.
No.
And they were knocking each other down.
Tonight Show. I went on Jimmy Kimmel Live. I went on one of the late night shows. And they just sat there and they were promoting a book, you know, that they're writing together. And at some point, you know, and they go, no, my mom wouldn't, you know. And they go, well, but if you did, who would win? Well, I mean, obviously I have a little more experience. But, you know, we would never fight. And then they start, and it started to escalate.
Uh-huh.
And it started to build where one of them got beat by Corey Sanders, but the other one never lost to Corey Sanders. And then shirts start coming off. And next thing you know, they start pushing. That would be a $200 million pay-per-view.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah. It would. Yeah. And it'd be like, look, you guys are brothers, but you fight other people that are trying to kill you. And you've both had 40 fights. Dial it down a little. Get your $100 million each on the pay-per-view and just go off into the sunset.
Get in there.
Because they would never fight each other. That's the big deal. But you'd fight. I'd fight my mom for 80 grand.
For fucking 50, I'd bite my mother's tits off for 50 million. Or 80 grand.
That would be interesting, watching a couple of brothers beat the shit out of each other. That yeah. isn't in a bar, you know.
That'd be
Irish
the
bar.
Only thing Irish that would rejuvenate the heavyweight division would be the Klitschkos.
Oh, they are both heavyweights. I know the names. I haven't followed those.
Oh, the two giants, and no one can beat them.
Who's champion?
Vladimir.
And the other guy won't be champion because he won't fight his brother. He'll fight whoever beats his brother if someone does.
I don't know. There's Vitaly and there's Vladimir. And I don't know if they're both champions or Vladimir's the champ. They'll figure it out. But either way, they almost never lose. They're 6'8". And, oh, yeah. You know, they're not into drugs.
I got to talk to you about your podcast. And
sure.
And as opposed to regular radio, as they call it. Do you think you'd still be on the air on regular radio? Saying what you've been saying over the past years, and it's nothing, believe me, but people deem it controversial and crazy.
Oh, yeah, I don't know. I used to say a lot of fucked up things on the air all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And so I never, it's weird.
But we're kind of in a different place now. It's so fucking weird now.
I know, but I don't think we're... I don't think people are more sensitive. I think people are bigger douchebags, and they just grab it. First off, there's a couple of things. It's a technology thing.
Mm-hmm.
Back when we used to do terrestrial radio back in the day, you'd say shit, but someone would have to send a cassette to your program director.
It's
like, listen, minute, hour, 3, minute, 18, 21 seconds, he makes a weird ching-chong joke when he's talking about Chinese food. I want you to review this, but he'd never get to it, and no one would ever figure it. Now, there's a technology, which is everyone grabs stuff. Everyone has their own official page that looks like some kind of news page, but it's just them in their shitty apartment with a hot plate, and they're banging it out on their Mac.
Yes.
But and it's like from World News, and they do this thing, and then they'll just, Adam Carolla, racist, and then they start throwing it out. So a lot of it's just technological. You couldn't grab these little bites and send these files. Listen to what he said. Right. Read the transcript. Email it to your friends. It didn't exist. So now it's a combination of everyone being super sensitive, although they don't give a shit.
They're just trying
to get you in trouble.
Of course
they are. They're not even the group. Whatever group you've offended, they're not even in that fucking group. They don't know anyone in that group. They've never had sex with anyone in that group. But they're trying. It's this whole Schadenfreude thing where, like, everyone's trying to get everyone into trouble. Yeah. Did you hear? Did you hear what Alec Baldwin, the way he spoke to his daughter? Oh, my God. It's like, really? That's a 2.5
mm-hmm.
to anyone who's ever grown up with parents, whose dad who got pissed off, right?
That's nothing.
And then here's the thing. Then it's all over the news, and all the pussy, hypocrite cowards have to sit there and go, and they look that shocked look on their face. Like, and when I heard that call, I was shocked. There's not one guy sitting in Good Morning America going, I don't know what the big whoop is.
Yeah, no
big
deal.
My dad used to beat me with a shoe.
Yeah.
Now they just go, oh, my goodness.
Feigned outrage.
Phony outrage.
It's righteous indignation. Yep. And then you get to be on the happy side of the issue. You see, you get to be on the good side of the issue. And whenever this stuff comes up, whether it's Trayvon Martin trial or whatever, Zimmerman, whatever, and everyone just sits there and goes, oh, my God, I don't know what to tell my kids. And now you're on the happy side. And meanwhile, you're going, we need to start a dialogue about, I'm a huge pussy, so I'm not going to say anything, but someone should have there needs to be a national dialogue on Alec Baldwin.
But they're not going
to
say anything that's not towing the company line, ever.
Right. But so, and by the way, they're just suggesting everybody, it's like standing next to a burning barn going, someone needs to put that barn out. Somebody's got to pick up a bucket with some. We need to start a national dialogue on putting that barn out.
As they continue to throw gasoline
right,
on
just
it.
And throw wood chips onto it.
Yeah. And talk about whoever set the barn on fire and try to get them in more trouble for it. Like, did you see him? I saw him. He was throwing hay on it.
Right. And then once in a while, a guy comes around and goes, well, honestly, we don't have enough wells dug in the community. We need to start. Okay, listen, troublemaker.
Hey, hey.
I'm focusing on the barn over here. You're trying to violate the soil. You're part of the problem.
Yeah. You're a soilist.
Right. Yeah, everyone's just a hypocrite and a pussy, and they can fuck themselves.
They love getting people in trouble. People, and when they say a dialogue should be started, the second you start an honest dialogue, did people crawl out of the woodwork to call you racist and fucking homophobic and misogynistic? There's no honest, open dialogue in this country. You're crucified the second you're honest about anything.
Yes.
I've been on Twitter talking about the Zimmerman trial for fucking ever since it started. And I can't tell you how many times I've been called a racist for doing nothing but quoting fact that is going about in this case. And statistics. No one wants to hear statistics about black and white.
Well, not when it gets in the way of their emotional argument.
Yeah.
And look, the only... If you approach every problem... Like, I mean, if a doctor comes to you and says you have emphysema and you need to quit smoking, you don't attack the doctor. He's giving you information.
Yeah.
You know, it might not be information you care to hear, but it's information. And if we're trying to cure a problem, you know, if you have gout or whatever you have, and he's telling you take it easy on the red wine, you don't go fuck that guy.
That doctor
let's go get
is
him.
Horrible.
Yeah, let's run him out of town. No, there is a problem. There is a remedy for the problem, and we should attempt to fix the problem. But if you attack the doctor who gives you the news, or the you know, look. Everyone wants to be on the cheeseburger diet, but the guy's going to come in and go, look, you got to eat a salad every once in a while. And if we attack him, we're not going to cure the obesity problem.
Uh-huh.
But and that's the honest dialogue we want to have, we claim to want to have, is with the doctor, but he gets run out of town the second he tells you to eat some kale.
Yeah, because, again, nobody really wants an honest dialogue.
Well,
they want to hear their side of it.
Nobody makes a living off of the bullshit.
Right. Yeah, yeah. It's astounding to me. I've been watching the coverage of the Zimmerman trial and the aftermath, and the revisionist history that's taken place in only a couple of days is amazing. There's no more, nothing, not a word on the news that he ever laid a hand on George Zimmerman.
Well,
now he was walking, he was black, he was an innocent boy walking with his Skittles, and Zimmerman followed him and shot him. That's the dialogue now. That's all you hear now.
Well, it's like, first off, the news, you know, these guys are going to get somebody killed.
Yes.
Because of their misreporting. And what happens is we're busy. People have one ear available, one eyeball available. We're not really that tuned into other people's shit. You're kind of into your own family, your own work, your own business, the hookers, whatever you got going on now, Jim. Right. Trolling online for prostitutes. Like, whatever you're into.
I knew you were just bringing me in.
you're into that. So you turn on the news, and it's just pretty much, well, black guy walking with Skittles, white guy shoots him in the back for no apparent reason, and all right, let's go burn down a liquor store. But it was the same thing. Look, it happens time and time again. When there was that poor kid who jumped off the Tallahatchie Bridge because his roommate was gay.
Right.
And they accused his roommate of filming him with his gay partners and then putting it up on the internet.
Did you hear about the GW, right?
Then having parties. It was nothing of the sort.
Uh-huh.
And the guy was not a criminal, and the guy was not homophobic, and the guy was not everything. The kid was depressed about teen suicide and about how to prevent teen suicide, but we're not going to have that dialogue.
No.
And about depression and 19-year-olds. 19-year-olds don't kill themselves because they got a crappy roommate. I would have killed myself 2009. You go, remember that story? Ah, yeah, where that guy had the homophobic roommate who pushed him off the bridge.
Yeah.
And it's like, no, that's not what happened. That has nothing to do with the story.
Yeah, yeah.
And even at the end, when the guy went to trial, they didn't have anything on him because I can sleep at night.
Yeah.
It's insane. Like, it's, you're homophobic, you're xenophobic, you're misogynist, yet no one's ever laid a hand on anyone.
No one's done anything
to anyone.
It's the perception of it.
Homophobic.
No.
They don't think George Zimmerman's white. Like, they don't even know. They just have a story, and they have to turn it into something.
They love it. It's the newsertainment cycle that goes on has nothing to do with actual news. And then you get these stations like HLN, which used to be headline news for CNN, and it was kind of the 20-minute cycle, and they would give you the headlines, and then you'd go to CNN if you want a more in-depth whatever. Now HLN, it's not headline news anymore, it's just HLN. It's still under the CNN flag, but it is nothing to do with news. It's Nancy Grace yelling her opinion.
Hey, that guy is good.
Backwards, her backwards-ass opinion on shit. And it's still disguised. People think it's the news.
I'd say more about it, but I have a lawsuit against them for the Jody Arias trial because it ruined my relationship with my wife because it's, she's wrapped up the last 19 months of her life laying in bed watching a woman who's killed her husband and killed her. And like, this is it? We're done? We're done going on with life because a chick who was a 7 shot a dude in the shower and stabbed. That's it? What if I just quit my life to watch a trial?
She was fully involved, huh?
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I'd give Jody an 8, though. Did you see those fucking fat pussy lips in those photos? You got to jump up to an 8.
Okay.
Anyone that hits their husband with a hammer and has a fat pussy is an 8.
You like that?
Yeah. All right. Yeah, but well, I'm just saying, once in a while, an attractive woman kills somebody. Let's get over it.
Yeah.
Move forward.
We can't believe it, though. That's the problem, is we don't like to admit that we can't. It's like why people were surprised Susan Boyle could sing, because we expect nothing out of pigs. So when an attractive person does it, we're utterly shocked.
What are you doing?
Casey Anthony, very attractive.
Yeah. No, I know. I know. It's so sad.
Yeah, yeah.
Fat people we expect to commit homicides for some reason. They're just unpleasant
general. Pleasant
people to be around. It's so true, though, when you see, like, a teacher out of Florida had sex with her 15-year-old student. You wait to reserve your judgment until you see the picture of the chick. And if she's hot and blonde and sitting on a Harley Davidson, you're like, what's the big whoop here? There's no. But if she's a pig, you're like, oh, that kid's life has been destroyed.
Poor kid.
Here's my argument is always the same argument. Like, if I was ever her defense attorney, I would take the 15, now 16-year-old boy up to the stand who was banging the super hot blonde, chick, and who was his teacher in Florida, and just go, look, Your Honor, ladies and gentlemen of the court, I'm not going to waste a lot of time here. All I have is one simple question. It's been a year since you two had intercourse. Have you beat off to her since? Remember, you're under oath.
Yeah.
All right. And would you say it'd be in 2000 or under? Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, how can there be a crime here? What vehicular manslaughter you don't beat off to? If you beat off to this, moving on. Moving on to the next case. How can you be traumatized by something you beat off to? Like, you get carjacked. Well, you might beat off to it. Someone holds you up at an ATM, you don't beat off to it.
Oh, right. That was great. I love
these
that
guys,
gun to my head.
She's in jail, and they're beating off to when the crime occurred.
Yeah. And that's true, though. Reserving judgment. Do that all the time. I want to see the second I see the headline, I click on the link, I'm like, I want to see the picture first. I want to see if she's hot.
Right.
That blonde on the fucking motorcycle, she was like incredibly hot.
I know.
And you're like, oh, where does that happen?
I don't know.
It's like magic.
No, I had like Mr. Saponzi, the fat guy with the male pattern baldness and the sweater vest and stuff. Yeah, like it smelled weird. Like where do these teachers even come from? Teachers. But can I tell you this? I went to my kid. I have twins. I went to their like first grade, whatever. Their teacher has a stud in her nose.
Wow.
Number one.
That,
number two, she's got the full-blown on top and the thing. And it's sitting on her desk. Like, it's a milkshake sitting on her desk. Like, the idea of the milkshake on your teacher. But it has her first name scrawled across it.
Oh, man.
And so I go walk over, and it's just her desk, and I can see the first name or Miss. And if you found out, it was a big deal. Like, if you found out your teacher's first name. They're all on a first name basis. The chicks are like 27 and wear go-go boots and have no
reason to. God, yeah, it's all very lovey touchy feely now.
Yeah,
first name basis.
They had a walkathon
for fitness.
Break out into a jog, and like Coach Marty'd be like, hey. Safety first, cool it down. Let's go. It's like walking for a 7-year-old is nothing. That's zero in the exercise, yeah, right. Zero calories burnt.
Seven-year-old in the morning. Walking. They're getting more exercise than walking in a circle. We're being told you're a busy man today.
Oh, yeah, I've got to go to New Jersey, actually. Ooh. Yeah,
they have. So braggart. What is it you promote? What's the main thing you want us to promote?
We got a couple things. We got Caroline's tonight, yes, and tomorrow night doing the live podcast, and then going down to Jersey and doing a Mangria. I got a booze. It's called Mangria. Should have brought some in.
Damn.
Oh, you guys would love this stuff. Yeah, it'll knock you on your ass.
Yeah.
But I invented a booze called Mangrian, which sold like over 100,000 bottles, and it's been incredible.
Damn.
So I'm doing a tasting out in New Jersey at noon today, and then another one tomorrow, and then here in Manhattan on Sunday. But you can go to CorollaDrinks.com, or you can go to AdamCorolla.com, and you can find... Oh, and I'm doing a crowdfunding thing for a new movie. I'm doing an independent film.
Oh, nice.
So you can go to fundanything.com/Adam and making another movie.
And Adam's podcast, of course, is it's in Guinness now as the most downloaded popular podcast. It's fucking amazing.
Yeah,
I wish we had more time with you, because what you did after leaving radio is fucking, it changed the way people look at regular radio and where guys can go after radio.
Well, feel free to speak about it for an hour or two when I'm gone.
It really is amazing. Fucking that podcast that you fucking just balls it out and are now a massive success.
It really is amazing.
It's great.
Thanks for coming in, man.
My pleasure.
And we'll be right back.
The Opie and Anthony Show.
Oh, yeah.
Makes me so happy that we're coming back with Sabbath.
Well, it's Jimmy's birthday today, so it's all about Jimmy. Whether it's playing music he likes when we come in, letting him talk like Edgar and poke us with his fingernails.
Well, you didn't give me that yet. That's what I want for my birthday.
I don't want you to
There's
have
been
that.
Been some
for
great
your
phone calls, and I've had a nice chat with Adam. But what I really wanted to have a conversation with everybody in the room as Edgar, and have you enjoy Edgar.
No one wants you to have that for your birthday.
There are some more phone calls.
Yeah, exactly. Wow, look who's on the phone. Hello.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Aww. Happy birthday, dear Jimmy. Ooh. Happy birthday to you.
Very
Thank
nice.
You. That was a lovely.
That is very nice.
That was a lovely
Jimmy.
Who is this? I don't recognize the voice.
It wasn't that. I was almost as good as DeRosa there.
Hi, Bill. How are you?
I'm good. I wanted to prove to Joe that if you really put your heart into it, you can sing a cappella.
Did you hear Joe's last appearance?
DeRosa? No. What did he do this time?
We gave him a real fucking beating about his tattoos. I think we helped him a lot.
Yeah.
Oh, no. Dude, his tattoos are so bad, like, I can't even trash him. I was actually worried about him. I thought he was a cry for help. I think he was possibly thinking about making an attempt on his life.
Do you know, I felt the same way. When I saw those tattoos, I'm like, I just wanted to hug him. And I went, "Dad, they're cool." I couldn't even mock him.
I felt bad for him.
Yeah, it's like when your friend marries a big fat girl. You just got to tolerate it and be nice. Oh, she's got great eyes.
Dude, his tattoos are like shit you like wrote on the cover of your notebook. In the most random places. I don't want to go. I still love the guy, but, you know, Jesus Christ. I don't understand what he got on his body, and I don't understand where he put it.
If placement is bad, the font is bad.
The only time you have tattoos on the parts of his arms that he does is if you have a full sleeve, and they're just covering... You know, coloring the whole thing in, but
that's all that's left.
It's the shoulder, maybe your shoulder blade, just like forearm. You know, this. Well, I guess he does have that kitten caboodle tattoo.
Kitten caboodle.
Wait, You think Joe Tattoo thinks that you'd write on your notebook in high school?
And then he tried to fix it and made it worse.
Oh, God, dude.
He tried to fix it, and he literally made it worse with the boxing it in. And now I don't even know how they could fix that.
Did you see the fix?
No. The thing about it is, you know something? This trashing's going to help him. If you're listening to the replay of this show with your knees in your chest, slowly crying into your favorite blanket, we're trying to help you.
Yes.
All right? You're not a tattoo guy.
No. He's not. And he's...
That's why I never got one. I'm too pasty. I'd have to get like a cheetah and like color in my freckles. I wanted to get a tattoo. I knew myself. I was just like, I'm going to look like the asshole who isn't a badass who got a tattoo. Like 90% of the people walking down the street.
Right.
I will give Joe this.
Why have tattoos become so accepted like that? And you're right. It should be people that have the look and attitude to have tattoos.
Yeah, you should have warrants.
Yeah. Yes, warrants. Know how to ride a motorcycle.
I think all leg tattoos should be outlawed. They never look good. And then the worst one is I know a couple of guys, they got one tattoo and it's down by their ankle.
Oof.
And I always say, what did you join a sorority?
A sorority. Fucking guy.
Yeah, they are very odd tattoos. And the fix he got on the KKITN or whatever is, it's a rectangle on the bottom. It's supposed to be a microphone, but it looks like a smoldering cigarette. Nobody knew what it was until he explained. It's the worst fix.
It looks nothing like a microphone.
No, not at all.
No.
Oh, God, now I feel even worse.
I feel so bad.
You know, you ever watch that show where they do all the cover-up tattoos?
Yes.
Yes.
Dude, they just make it bigger. Oh. It's always a rose or some sort of skull.
Yes. They can't do anything but the rose. A lot of roses on the fixes.
This tattoo, I didn't even think it was that bad. And then it looks like they put like a fucking Christmas wreath.
Yeah, Christmas. It does look like that.
Where, Travis?
Thing on one side, never forget. You're like, oh, this is a proud Jewish man. And then you see a Christmas wreath, and you're like, oh, wait a minute. Which side? I was listening to a replay. One of my favorite things I ever heard was Louis C.K. describing driving in with his kids, trying to listen to the show.
Oh, yeah.
And even Bobby was, like, cursing too much. When he did that, he'd be like, fucking, I was down the village. I didn't even think about that.
Yeah. Hey, Bill, I just texted you a photo of Joe's tattoo.
Oh, man. I'm stunned.
Dude, his tattoos, it's becoming like Michael Jackson's face, where you're just like, all right, just stop.
Just stop. Yeah, stop, please.
You lost, let it go, stop.
Yeah, I got that quote on the front page of his website.
Some comic does?
Keep kicking him in the nuts, yeah.
No.
And it's like, and it says George Carlin underneath. Like this, it wasn't a personalized quote that George gave to Joe.
Yeah.
He apparently said it to every comic he met.
I know, Joe should get Keep on Trucking on his other arm.
I can't do this, guys. It's just too mean.
Oh, too mean. No. I heard he put, if this van's a rockin', don't come knocking on his thigh.
I still love you, Joe, if you're listening to this.
I love Joe.
And here's the positive spin we'll put on it. They're already making leaps and bounds in the tattoo removal field, which is probably a great thing to invest in the future, considering every fucking moron out there. It's like if John Denver was still alive, he for some reason would have a sleeve. You know what I mean?
Yeah, it's become accepted, and it shouldn't be. Exactly. It should be. It's special for people that punch other people or hit them with pool cues.
Well, I'm getting, I don't know if you know this, but I'm getting G-G-O-A-N-R-F-F.
What's that?
Gas, grass, or ass. Nobody rides for free. a guy said that to me once.
Yeah, because some guy said that.
Oh, poor Joe.
Poor Joe.
Ditching time saves nine. That's
a tramp stamp. And, dude, check your text message just see if it came through. You got to see the fix. It's wonderful.
The fix is... I don't understand.
I can't. I love the guy too much. I've looked away enough. I can't do it.
Yeah.
I don't know what he's doing. I'm worried about the man.
I don't know who the tattoo guy is that keeps doing this, too. Who is this fucking, this sadistic prick?
I'll tell you who. The same guy who was knocking out Michael Jackson every night.
Oh, okay. I get it.
The malpractice guy. He'll do anything.
It's fucking, like, if Joe said, put a microphone around this to, like, frame it, and the guy did that, like, I'd shoot him. That is not a it's not a microphone. It looks like a smoldering cigarette.
Listen, guys, I think we're beating a dead horse here.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Point, we just keep making the same point, and I'm going to push Joe over the edge.
No, but the thing right. is, Bill, the point feels better every time we make it. It's just, it feels wonderful to make over and over.
It would be dishonest if we didn't just go for the killers.
I know.
The show is all about.
But you're right, though.
I just feel bad because he's not here to defend himself.
Yeah, you're right. I love Joe, man. He's one of my favorite guys.
Man,
go out drinking
when
he's
with. Down, laying yeah. down on a tattoo table.
What do you got going on, Bill?
Nothing.
Nothing.
I got a phoner here. I got to do in like another 15 minutes.
Oh.
But I wanted to call Jimmy Norton.
Thank you, Bill.
Very nice.
The adorable Jimmy. And wish him a happy birthday.
Thank you, brother.
Nice, Jimmy.
Very cold. All right, Bill, thanks for calling, man. And we'll see you when you get into New York at some point.
Thanks, buddy.
Bye, gentlemen.
See you soon, Bill.
Bye.
Funny fucking dude.
Right.
Bill's a funny fucking guy, man.
That is, he put it right there with, it looks like something you draw on your notebook in school.
You mean the nuts? It's on my fucking math book.
We actually have another birthday call.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Oh, they're rolling in here.
It's a surprise.
Let's see if we can guess who it is. I like the guessing part. Hello?
Happy birthday, Jimmy! You gotta go ring the doorbell, because you all know what happens. There's two other certain people. Well, I don't know. They're human, but they make noise when you hear the doorbell. And they want to wish you happy birthday.
Oh, his dogs want to wish you a happy birthday.
What?
Bobo? Did he put the phone down?
I think he did.
And then walk to the door?
This is the perfect birthday call.
But what's...
He's still on the phone.
He's not in a mansion. He's at the fucking Bobo Manor. Where he's got...
Then two yelps.
A schnoodle yelp?
Yeah. A schnoodle.
Bobo?
Yeah, you there?
What happened?
No, that was the dogs.
We didn't hear anything.
We didn't hear anything.
I didn't hear
a hint of a dog anywhere during that.
Well, I put the phone on.
There, now I hear the dogs.
Yeah.
Oh, I wish they'd the sound of them ripping Bobo's throat out.
Bobo, yeah. We've been reading your tweets.
Yeah, Bobo, your tweets are great. What's the matter?
Yeah, no.
Why are you mad at Colin?
Oh, well, a long time ago, I don't know, I remember years ago, 2010,
yeah.
He had promised me tickets to, long story short, it never happened.
I don't think he promised you tickets to anything.
I never got to.
All right.
And you want free tickets? You asked to go on the bus trip. You asked to come to a party at my house. You asked for fucking tickets to the All-Star game. You asked for tickets to the All-Star festival. You asked for tickets to Colin's first play.
Yeah,
you asked for tickets to this play. Last night you were asking for tickets for San Diego for your cousin or something. You're constantly begging for free shit. Bobo, comment.
Yeah, well, maybe he'll be quiet about it for a while.
Like the fucking, like the birthday tweet. I blocked you today again.
Because
you sent me a tweet on my birthday. Happy birthday. I'm a fan. I wish you were nicer to me.
Yeah,
how am I not nice to you? I don't set you on fire. That's nice.
No, come on, Jimmy. Please unblock me.
Oh, he's crying now.
No, he's not. All you had to do is say happy birthday, and I would have wrote back thanks.
Yeah, why'd you have to follow it up with why don't you be nice to me?
And, Bobo, why did you tweet me and say, no, I will not call into...
God damn it. I just got 10 Edgar nails.
Bobo, you weren't invited to call into the after show, and you still tweet, no, I will not call into the after show. Nobody asked you to.
Boy, I felt that day. I knew Colin wouldn't call in.
What?
I was hoping Colin would call in and see how it goes.
Who's coming?
Edgar's coming
away,
over.
Go away, Edgar.
Edgar's Hi, coming Bob, over to Sam.
Go away.
Isn't that horrible?
Oh, so much of it.
Edgar just...
No, Edgar! Get away from me.
That's my birthday. I want to Edgar everyone.
Oh, I hate this.
Oh,
did it feel bad?
Being still Edgar. With me. Oh, it's terrible.
Yeah. I still feel it.
Edgar's touch lingers like a good juicy gasser, like a good cancer fart. Oh. No. It's my birthday.
What happened?
Get away from me, Edgar.
Wait, shit.
Go away.
Ew. Don't you?
I hate it.
I hate Edgar and his dumb nails.
That sharp one.
Oh, I thought we were supposed to get Colin on the phone with Bobo.
He hung up.
Yeah, it's going to voicemail now. So.
Oh, good.
Oh, it is? He doesn't want to talk to
I wouldn't want to talk to Bobo.
Why? What, Colin's legitimately getting mad at you, Bobo.
He should.
Come on, Colin. I'll do anything for him to be on my good side again.
But you're being a nudge. You say you'd do anything. Just stop doing what you're doing. You're being a nudge to him.
Yeah. All right, well, I'll stop tweeting to him if he's nice to me, right?
If he's nice
it's
to me.
It's always something
what is that,
in
a
return.
Threat? Are you threatening him?
No. I mean, I am going to stop bothering him on Twitter, and hopefully he'll talk. He'll talk, all right? And Jimmy, please unblock me.
All right. Get to it. We heard you.
I'll stop bothering him if he gives me free tickets.
Bubba, you got to stop asking for free stuff, okay?
Oh, God.
Okay, and also, I didn't need to ask for free tickets to the fan fest.
Shut your face. What is your dumb Twitter name again?
Bobo XM103.
Bobo.
The Moocher. Let me tell you a story about Bobo the Moocher. He has two piece of shit pooches.
Happy birthday to you.
You.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jimmy, Edgar, Chip, Uncle Paul, and Ted Sheckler.
Such a nudge.
Oh, my God. Everybody. Is he a fucking nosy Nancy? Poking his head in.
Yeah. What do you got? You got any birthday plans, Jimmy?
Big ones today. I got.
Yeah?
Oh, fun day ahead.
Oh.
Right to the gym, to where it gets good. Uh-huh. I go home, and I'm having shelving put in. So they they banged up the ceiling, so they have to repaint the ceiling where they scuffed it and finish putting in the shelving that I ordered and paid for and realized is not the size I wanted.
Oh, no.
And then, later, I do the Artie Lang show tonight, which is nice.
Okay.
And then I travel to Pennsylvania. I'm doing a gig tomorrow night with Amy, Artie, and David Tell, and it's first show sold out. Second show tickets available, and that's it.
That's a good one.
I bought these shelves, floor-to-ceiling shelves, to display my shit on.
Sure.
And I had 12-inch deep shelves.
Yeah.
Because I could put my little basketball displays on them and fucking stuff. So the guy says to me, I said I wanted lights in the unit. A few of the levels will have lights. Not everyone. And he goes, okay, but I should probably put it back on it, because if I put it back on it, the wiring, this way it protects you from the wire. He goes, I'll paint the back the same color as the wall. This way you don't have wires dangling because it looks sloppy.
Oh, boy. Well, let me tell you, that takes up a little room.
You bet it did.
Oh, no.
So I don't know if he mentioned it, but I didn't think to ask. So now my fucking shelving units are too short to fit my basketball.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
Oh, good.
Happy birthday.
Wow.
Oh, thank you
Holy
very much.
Holy mackerel.
Oh, lovely.
What
Madam
we got here?
Holy Toledo.
Wow. Hi, how are you?
Happy birthday.
Well, thank you. Here, put it down there so you don't burn yourself. What?
You have to blow your candles out.
Oh.
Make a wish.
Wow.
My goodness.
What have we got
Woo!
Here?
Very nice.
Happy birthday.
Thank you. What is it? What kind of cake is that? Is that cheesecake?
Cheesecake.
Wow, that looks really good. What's your name?
Wow.
Mary Jean.
Hi, Mary Jean. Mary Jean. Oh, you can. Oh, headquarters. Such a good place.
Love
She'll
that.
Be at headquarters. Oh. Gentlemen's Club. This Tuesday night at 10 o'clock, it's Wild Cherries Burlesque Night. And, Brittany Andrews, who I like a lot, it will be there. She's the DJing. And you're very, very beautiful.
Thank you.
What nationality are you? Black and white? Are you mixed?
I'm Dominican.
Oh, Dominican?
Dominican!
Wow. Oh,
nice.
Dominican women are...
I can like you.
They're scary, though. They're very beautiful.
I'm likable.
Yeah?
They're very, very bad
an ice cream sandwich.
Not me. Yeah.
My goodness.
I'm a good melting. Girl.
What's that?
Hello. Cuban made that one.
Two cakes.
The Cuban made what?
The cheesecake.
Oh, my, an ice cream cake.
Oh, this is so melty. Pretty.
And we have ice cream.
They melt it.
I won't have any sandwiches, but I mean.
They're melting.
Anthony, give the lovely, didn't even wait for everyone else.
No.
Give Mary Jean a nice.
Chipwich.
What's that?
Oh, Mary Jean. Oh, hi, how are you?
Wow. These are like chipwich.
You look really great.
Thank you.
I like that whole, whatever they call that, a body thing. Yeah, you like my little stars?
Yeah, you do look rather lovely.
That's really nice. You must do very well at the club. I try. Yeah. What do you got going on? Cake? What are you doing? Of course I'm having cake. Yeah. I want to feed you some cake, though. Oh feed nice. Jimmy some cake. Yeah. Only because it's your birthday.
It is my birthday.
Mm.
I just want a little piece. I have to go to the gym right after this.
I'll give you a good workout.
You can't even eat it. Why?
Because it's too melty. If I bit into it, it would squirt out the side
great.
Like that.
Yeah, it's good.
That's
looks
pretty
like a
good,
cookie
though.
Is coming in your mouth.
Yeah, it is good, right?
Oh, it's really good.
Mm-hmm.
I can only have
we're cutting the cake. And
yeah.
You got to feed little Jimmy. Like that'll be
yeah,
adorable.
Yeah, really tiny, because, again, I'm on no sleep, and I'm going to get murdered in an hour.
Oh, yeah?
Oh,
but it's so sweet.
Yeah, I know, but I can't. I'm trying not to be a fucking fat-titted monster.
How do you stay in shape there, Missy?
I just go to... Oh.
Not you. What do you do? I walk up and down the stairs a lot. Like, I won't take the elevator or escalator.
What
yoga.
Floor do you live on? Second.
Yeah, where are
you?
26. Where are you going? Oh, really? So six. You're like... Yeah, but I walk, like, up the stairs in the parking lot. That's a lot of work. Yeah, huh? Do guys get behind you sometimes? And they're like, this is the best walk I've ever had. Sometimes. Guys love walking behind hot girls walking upstairs.
Absolutely.
And by the way, if you think they're looking at your ass... You can know they're looking at your ass the entire time. But they time. Mostly just stop, and I'm like already up the stairs. That's how you can look downstairs. Up a skirt. Oh,
yes.
The
upper
skirt I know. Level. Yeah. We gotta look now up the skirts. I got some skirts. Tricks when I want to look up girls'
oh,
skirts.
Yeah, you follow them closely on the escalator. Oh, thank you.
Wow.
this looks really good.
Oh, you should. You should feed Jimmy. Anybody?
Holy
no,
shit.
I'm good. Can I feed you? Is that good? Oh, let her feed
me
a little
yeah.
bit.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. Aw,
wow,
look at that. I want a picture.
Good.
I got to get a picture of this.
Paul.
Oh, let me see.
Oh, my God.
There we go.
Yeah.
Mm. Oh, that's so adorable.
That's really amazing. Listeners love when we eat. They're so happy for me.
The listeners love when we eat on the air.
Oh, good. This should be podcast material. Jim has delicious cake.
It could nice be the nugget. Creamy.
Oh, it's fucking amazing.
You got yourself one of them boyfriends?
No.
No way. What are you, a girl or a girl? No, I love my boys, but I love girls too, so. Yeah, but no boyfriend? But no boyfriend. What's up with that? Are you a bitch on wheels? No way. Are you a bitch on wheels? No? No, I'm just really picky and, you know. Yeah, your nose? see, that would turn guys off. Yeah. Speak for yourself.
Exactly.
You picky your nose. No, when was the last time you had a boyfriend? Oh, my gosh. Long time. Like, I was still in college. That's what how... the fuck? Do you like, date or are you like... I try to go on dates, but, you know. Happens. Hmm. Are they dull? No. They're more like a headache, but they're cool. Really?
Why yeah. headache?
Because they just stare at me, and they don't want to know who I am. They just like, can I have sex with you? And I'm like... Oh, these fucking assholes. Just wait geniuses. Till like the hour goes by and then ask. Right? Why would they ask right away? After dessert. Hi, pleasure to meet you. Can I have sex with you? It's crazy. At it's least, yeah. Much. So, are we done here? Check, please. Can I have sex with you? Like, feed me and I'm happy. Like, you get to my tummy and I'm just like, yeah. I'll give you a blowjob. Wow.
Wow. Here's some cake.
Wow, that's pretty cool. Okay. Well, you can't take me to, like, McDonald's or Wendy's. No. Like, good places.
Yeah.
Only maybe Wendy's. Where would a girl like you find guys to go out with? Because it's got to be very difficult. You don't want to get the guys that come to the club, right? No. They're like, you know, hey, baby. I love them all, but... Yeah, of course you do. I know, but going out and stuff. Where do you meet guys? Where? Well, I used to go out before. Like, yeah, go out to the club. But it's never the same, though. Like, yeah. Huh. Oh, yeah, everybody's so intoxicated. You can't, like, really, like, talk over the music.
All right, I'm out.
Yeah. I just come on this show and maybe talk to you guys.
Do you mind talking to a guy who's got his fucking floor on the linoleum? Do you mind?
Floor on the linoleum?
I'm in the same face. I'm on a sugar high. I ate some cake and I'm loopy.
Jimmy said floor on the linoleum.
Yes, I meant to say that because sometimes your floor is on the
That is
face.
True.
Where did you grow up?
I grew up
Anthony.
In the Bronx.
Where?
In the Bronx, Capitol Hill.
Yeah? Worked your way out of there? Worked your way out of the hood?
The hood. Castle Hill at the time, it was still decent when I lived there.
It's not bad.
It's still the same, but, you know, it helped me grow, like, as a person. So, like, I look back at it as, like, thanks, Mom.
Are you still Mary Jean from the block?
I'm still Mary Jean from the block. I still go over there all the time, though.
Did you read Random Family? It's a great book about... you read it?
Yes.
Yeah, it's about a family from the Bronx.
Books are for nerds.
Yeah, I know, but you know, I was just clearing up a little bit.
You might as well say Dropout now.
Really?
Yeah. Well, he is, and so am I. We're total educational zilches. But it's about this woman, Adrienne, who's writing the book on comedy. Who we see, who spent 10 years with a family in the Bronx, and it's an amazing fucking book.
Jesus,
it's an amazing
10
story.
Years?
Yeah.
How do you commit to a 10 years?
Every sentence
sounds like one of E-Rock's fucking movies. The whole decade, it's fucking 20 minutes long.
So you grew up in the Bronx. How far from Yankee Stadium? That's everybody's gauge in the Bronx.
Oh, my gosh. Like 30 minutes.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
oh,
like everybody thinks just like because you're from the Bronx, they automatically think like Hut's Point or like, you know, like the worst places
the
ever.
The worst places. Right, right.
Even though Hut's Point was near like Castle Hill, it is, but still.
Hut's Point's that's a little crazy.
Sorry to interrupt. Who set the fucking studio up this morning?
Uh-oh.
Okay, my headset's been cutting out all day. Why do I have STU on my headset instead of Jim?
They forgot the PID.
Doesn't even make sense. Kids do.
I don't get it.
I
was like, I want to laugh too, but I need to get the joke.
He's calling me stupid. He's saying, man. Here's the fucking genius of that. Who did this?
Oh, God.
What does STU mean?
I don't know.
Studio.
Oh, studio. So you just got regular guests. Ew. Bobo was probably wearing those.
I couldn't think. No wonder I said floor on the linoleum. Yeah.
Jen has cooties now.
That line was so lightning fast. Why do I have STU? Because they forgot the PID. I wish I could explain the process that a mind has to go through.
Now.
It's just, see? There you go. Yeah. You want a new set of headphones?
No, it's falling the word in my head. I'm like,
All right. That's okay. You're gorgeous. I'm going to have to get those things right away. Yeah. Where'd you go to school? Bronx?
No, I went down on 24th Street, Fashion Industries.
Oh, fashion.
FIT.
Right away?
No, I went to the high school. I went to FIT, but I dropped out.
Yeah.
Then I went to regular college. I was like, yeah, right. If I be a nurse, I'll leave the needle in your arm and, like, freak out.
Yeah, so you don't want that.
Yeah, so then I just went to beauty school, to Paul Mitchell Academy, and graduated from there. And
did you cut hair?
I cut hair. I dye hair.
Yeah?
I don't like to style hair, but I'll do it if I have to.
Yeah.
Do you have a little piece of ice cream cake? This is what a fucking...
Ice cream cake?
Yes, of course it is. This is what a fucking fatso I've turned into in my life. There's a 10 talking right now, and she's in a fucking bikini, and I'm like, before it melts, let me have a piece. I really should be fucking stabbed in the mouth.
Ice cream cake.
I like this, though. Like, I love food.
Yeah?
So, yeah.
Where do you put it? You don't even have a...
In my ass.
In your ass? Nice. All right, let's call this a steak.
More like a table.
Let's call this a steak.
Like, it doesn't even fit. My ass is, like, coming out back.
Do you have a table? I didn't see your ass.
Could you stand up for a sec? I'd love
I'll
to,
show my ass.
Oh, my God.
See that ass.
Oh, boy.
Look at that, huh?
Oh, my God.
You got a juicy ass there, right?
Oh, my God.
Nice and juicy.
Wow.
Yeah, Dominican girls are fucking amazing.
Yeah.
But they're all outside. They're fucking psychotic.
Get out of here.
Psycho girl?
They get very, very angry. Dominican
when
women.
When you lie, we do.
Oh, okay, shit.
You see, already she has a reason.
Yeah.
Being defensive here. I'm like, whoa.
But no, they're very, very fucking sexy.
What's your preferred weapon? A shank? What do you like?
Hands.
Oh, your hands? You'll choke a motherfucker out.
More like my mouth. But
yeah?
Like, yeah.
You bite?
Only if you axe.
Oh, okay.
She has wonderful teeth, too.
Thanks.
You look really good.
Thanks.
All of you, head to toe. Jesus Christ.
Yeah. I'm not going to have that much. You're going to have some. Come on, have some cake.
Some cake.
It's not ice cream. Ice cream cake. Throw that garbage on the floor.
It's not ice cream cake.
I'll have a bite or two. Thank you.
It's regular, like, golden kind of cakey cake.
Yeah.
This is so festive. I like this.
No, I feel like I want to have confetti somewhere and just...
Right? Just throw it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Have some cake.
You want a piece?
Yeah, sure.
Come on, give us...
I was all shy, but I'm ready for
it. Now, everyone likes to see a beautiful woman. You always want a pretty girl who eats.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, I don't like to go out to dinner with someone who doesn't eat. It's the worst.
I hate when they order salads, like girls. I'm like, come on.
Yeah. Come on, girls, right?
Stop it.
Yeah.
What are you
embarrassing me now.
Yeah.
You're making me feel fat.
If I'm out with a girl and she's really pretty and she orders a big meal, I'll be like, well, I hope you're going to puke that up. Because I don't date no heifers. And I'll say it exactly like that.
That's
Do guys
right.
actually look at the pricing? Like, of course, I don't know. Like,
never. No, but I would do that to my ex-girlfriend as a joke.
Shit. Oh,
it would
my
be funny.
God, that's right.
Like, just to embarrass her, like, the waiter would come over, and she'd be like, all right, I'll have the porterhouse, and I would always go, wait, how much is that?
Oh,
wait, how much is that?
How much?
And she was like, do you understand how embarrassed that is? Because they think that you're this guy and that I fuck you. They think I fuck a guy who would ask me that. So it was fun just to annoy her, but.
Oh, my God.
No, you
that
can never.
Would be very embarrassing.
If you commit to going out to dinner, you can't fuck
Nah, money should be no object when you're out on a date with a lovely lady. You take her to a restaurant.
If life was only that easy.
You're not thinking, why? What happens? You go out and guys are like a little stingy?
They look at me like, are you going to pay the bill? I'm like, yeah, right.
What?
No, I'm just joking. That would never happen.
No way.
Wow.
What do you like to eat?
Mostly, like, I love meat.
Yeah.
I don't eat any type of seafood, so.
No?
No, but I love, like, steak.
Oh, yeah.
Mexican food. Like, I'm obsessed. I eat Mexican food every day. I eat Mexican food before
really?
Coming here.
Damn.
What'd you eat?
A chicken quesadilla with chicken.
Quesadilla.
I know. I can't pronounce it. I think it's my Dominican side.
No, that's a bunch of dijas.
Yeah.
A case of them.
I have no shame in my game.
Quesadillas.
How do you pronounce it? Teach me.
I think it's quesadilla.
That's nice. Too far. You teach
quesadilla.
Me later.
Yeah.
There's certain words I can't pronounce, but who cares?
Yeah, would I like to teach you some diction? Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Teach you
what
a little
I wanted.
Grammar and phonics.
Phonics.
Some phonics.
Whatever happens to phonics?
I don't know. Where did phonics go?
No one
cares
like
about phonics these days. No one cares about some good phonics.
God damn, is this cake.
You
fucking,
like the cake,
oh
Jimmy?
Oh, my God.
It's your special day.
I love
Enjoy
the
it. Enjoy it.
No, I don't. I'm
fine. Just one
no,
minute.
No, I got to go to the gym. I can't.
Yeah.
My fucking trainer's going
to
murder
me. Just go to the bathroom. Take a break.
Oh, I will. Oh, well, I haven't since you walked in. It's a thing I do.
She eats Mexican food. She knows about the bathroom.
No way. Never. No, I never do those
you don't
things.
You don't wreck a toilet?
Never. I don't know what you're
girl.
Talking about.
Good girl. We don't like even thinking about that stuff.
I plead the fifth.
As men.
Gross.
We don't. It is gross.
So
do
gross.
Have guys like... Been.
They would never do that. Like, even if you, like, try to burp in front of me, I'm like, stop it. That's gross.
Right.
You don't
want
to hear me, so vice versa.
See, the thing
yes.
is, though,
vice versa,
I would
exactly. want to
hear you. That's where you're wrong. I
Get
would encourage
here.
You to burp. Yeah, why
really?
Not be you? You want a guy who likes you. I don't expect you to be this fucking image of perfection. You're a person, so I'm not saying I want
Behind
you.
Behind closed doors, not in front of you, though.
Why not? Who cares?
Right.
Because I
don't blow it at me if you ate hot dogs, but I mean,
oh,
God.
But at least
so
you know, crack the window a little bit and burp up towards it.
No
fucking
way.
Let me hear it. I
Never.
Like a girl who can
no.
fucking fire one out.
Maybe You're this is why I'm single because I don't like burping in front of guys.
I like that, and I don't like doing any of that stuff in front of a lovely lady. I think it's terrible
no.
and rude. I do. I've actually gone home in pain, doubled over in pain because I didn't want to. You know, do anything that would be rude.
Oh,
so instead of shitting somewhere, he drove home. Fuck, he drove home like so ready to shit his pants at his
nice
fucking.
Nice and sweaty.
No, but,
and like,
but he was stiff legging where your ass is up off the chair. So you're doing a fucking 98 miles an hour because your foot is jammed onto the gas.
Imagine he's taking public transportation.
That's what a girl wants, to almost be killed because you can't get to the brake fast enough.
I can't. Well, you know what? Before you go out, you have to completely, you know, make sure you've taken care of all the business. So there's no surprises midway through the date.
Well,
so you take care of everything beforehand. You make sure you eat and drink like a civilized person, so you're not like, you know, having to go to hit the
bathroom. I should have Mexican food this morning.
Oh, man.
This conversation is like so weird.
I don't do
these things. So I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I hear you. I do the same thing. I was once in a hotel room with a girl, and I made an excuse as to why I had to go down to the lobby for some reason. I was like, oh, the key doesn't work.
Yeah.
And I used the lobby bathroom. Because I did not want to use the bathroom in the hotel room because, boy, there's no room in there.
That's true.
You open that door and, boy, everyone knows what was going on.
I was dating a girl one time and I went into the bathroom and committed what is the equivalent of a homicide. And she came in and she texted me later. She goes, "You asshole, I was almost late for work because of your shit smell."
I'm like,
what do you mean? She's like, "I couldn't brush my teeth. I had to wait to go in there." I literally, she couldn't have made me happier if she said, "You won the Powerball."
You liked that?
Oh, my God.
Well, if we could hold on for 2 seconds or longer, we have another birthday wish caller.
Oh, good.
That wants to talk to Jimmy. Hello.
Happy birthday, little Jimmy. I remember one time we were peeing next to each other at a urinal and I complimented you on your fat cock.
Oh, my God.
Thank you very much.
This could be a gentleman from a truck stop.
Nice and big.
I know. This could be one of 10,000 people.
It's your old priest, Father.
So, I was so impressed because we were so nervous because we were doing the audition of a lifetime and we were in the... That stall, I looked over and I said, "Man, you have a really big dick, Jim." And you said, "Thanks, Bert."
Oh, Bert Kreischer.
Bert Kreischer.
See, I would have known it was you if you said you texted me a photo. Then I would have known it was Bert. Fuck, boy, the celebrity calls have really dropped off. Fuck, we had Mike Tyson and Chuck Liddell.
Yeah.
And then it goes to Bobo and my fucking pal, Bert. I love Bert. I love Bert, but I could call Bert.
Someone texted me, he's like, "You want to call Jim for his birthday?" I was like, "Oh, I have his number. I'll give him a call." He's like, "No, in the studio."
Who texted you?
Roland.
Boy, Roland, really, his fucking connections really go off a cliff. It is amazing. We have everyone on the UFC. We get one guy from the UFC, and of course, Mike, and then fucking Bobo. I can't.
Yeah.
Daly's on hold.
Well, thank you very much, buddy. Where are you?
I'm getting ready to take motorcycle class.
What?
What is that? What do they just show? What is motorcycle class?
They teach you how to ride a motorcycle.
No one takes a class. You hop on,
exactly.
You ride, you fuck up, you figure it out.
What a dork.
What kind of a...
That's what Jay Williams, the point guard from the Bulls, said.
Yeah?
Yeah, he blew out his leg, destroyed his career. It was on Real Sports last week. Well, so I'm taking the class, Anthony.
Well, what kind of career can you blow out with a knee?
Yeah, what do they show you? What do they show you? Footage of him falling and go, "Avoid this at all costs."
Yeah, yeah.
You'd be shocked how many people in this class should never be on a fucking motorcycle.
That's
like,
true.
Literally 10 people out of the 13 shouldn't be behind the wheel
of Paul McCartney's ex-wife.
Oh, I thought my gosh.
Yeah, I was trying to. Yeah, wow.
Yeah, so I'm taking motorcycle classes, and then I get my license.
Motorcycles are very dangerous. They're inherently dangerous,
yes.
Not so much because of the motorcycle or the rider, but the other people around. They suck. I drive a giant SUV, and people cut right in front of me. They're like, "Oh, I didn't see you." Yeah, I'll drive a goddamn tank. Never mind a motorcycle.
I'll be like a wet dick at an orgy around your SUV. I'll be in and out. You'll never even see me.
I know, that's true. I see these guys zipping in and out of traffic. Fucking right between cars. It's very scary.
That's how I drive.
Do you drive a motorcycle?
No, but
hot.
I drive my car like that. I'm like, get out the way. Like, they could hear me.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's why I got in.
If you drove a motorcycle, you'd be like an action hero.
Yeah.
Oh, no way. I would just fall.
Black leather
suit. I can't even ride a bike. I'll just be like, whoop.
Are you uncoordinated?
Sometimes.
Oh.
Any help on that, too?
This is the lovely Mary Jean. She's in here today helping
Hi.
Jimmy eat his cake.
Yeah, she's a very lovely dancer from headquarters.
From headquarters.
And we would love to talk to you longer, but I'm sitting next to a half-naked woman who is feeding me cake, and now I'm hearing about your James Dean experiment.
I'll talk to you guys later. Are you going to be in Montreal?
I will be there.
Yeah,
where all the show is going up there. We come up next Wednesday.
All right, I'll see you guys around there.
All right,
take
brother.
Care,
thanks, brother.
Easy, man.
All right, later, man.
That sounds like cool. Are you guys excited about going to Canada?
Oh,
you've been
yeah.
there before, right?
Yeah, maybe.
Well, yeah. But it's pretty good. You get there very often, Canada?
No, I've never been out there. I've been dying to.
Yeah, you should.
I haven't had like a friend to actually go with me. I usually go by myself, but I don't want to go to Canada by myself.
Do you have any arrests or anything? Because they ask you that shit at the border.
Really?
Yeah. They ask you.
I'm fucked.
Any hijinks, shenanigans in your background? You're Dominican. What, you crazy glue an ex-boyfriend's dick to his shin or something?
No.
Funny, you went from stomach. They're Irish, it's to the stomach. If yes. They're fucking Dominican, it's to the shin.
Shin.
I had a little incident when I was 21.
Oh, okay. Do tell.
Yeah, what'd you do?
What happened?
Tell on the record.
I hope this doesn't bite me in the ass, but...
Oh, lucky thing, whatever it would be.
It was just a drunk night, open bar, and the girl threw her beer at me. I was dancing on top of the table. I fell, and the beer bottle kind of hit her face, and she got 57 stitches.
Oh my
and
God.
She was, like, obsessed with me, though.
Did they continue the communion?
I called the cops myself because I knew I hurt this person, so I knew I was wrong. I got arrested, of course. I'm like, who gets arrested? They call the cops, and you know, you get arrested. But
Zimmerman.
Oh, shit.
Well, yeah.
So the he was the cop. Can you believe they're giving his gun back?
Well, no, now they decided they're going to keep it for evidence for this not-going-to-happen civil trial.
Oh.
But I put on, and I do stand by this, I will buy George Zimmerman another gun to protect himself with until he could get his gun back. Oh. I'm going to talk to his brother, and I'll toss him one of mine. I'll fucking give him the eagle if he wants. You know what?
Jail was great, though. I had, like, the girls are awesome. Like, we took naps on each other. Like, it was this young girl. She got arrested because she hit a cop in the hand because it was some crazy story. But she saved me an apple. Like, that was
he seems
nice
gotten
and
sick.
Slippery.
He got sick and threw up.
He threw up. He was eating fucking porridge, apparently.
Oh, no. The apple.
Yeah.
Yes, the apple. Another caller, though.
Oh, cool. Well, the
an hour ago. Happy birthday.
Hi, buddy. Hi, Colin.
I called an hour ago, and I got the fucking Paul Anka treatment again from this show.
Oh, I didn't even know you called.
Paul Anka treatment.
Rolling Anka me again. Don't worry. I'm listening to Bill Burr, and I go to myself, what am I doing? Bill Burr, like any other comedian, is not going to shut up. I might as well just fucking... He went on a... All you did was mention one topic, Joe's tattoos, which is probably discussed for like 8 hours. He goes on another riff for about 25 minutes. And I was like, what am I doing sitting on the phone listening to this goddamn horse? Plus, Norton, I know he's birthday boy, the hypocrisy of him going, I felt bad for Joe when I first heard it. Really? The guy that grovels every time Ozzy comes in like a 10-year-old girl from 1975?
I did feel bad about Joe's tattoo.
Shut up. You're like him with Ozzy.
No. I felt bad. Yes. I felt bad because they were so bad. I knew that I wanted to tease
them.
They
were bad tats, yeah.
And there was no one there to tease them with me.
You would actually have Ozzy tattoos all over your body if your body would. I don't think your body accepts tattoos.
Hey, by the way, how did Roland get these guests? What, did he go through my phone and call people I know? They're all my friends.
We are the worst.
Oh, it's a fucking... I mean, you know, it's good to hear from Colin, as always, but by the way, how it really is the shittiest drop-off. We had two amazing fucking phone calls in a row.
Wait, I'm here.
Oh, you, yes, we are on the phone. A very delightful young lady is here.
Well, I do also want to, plunk that down. Maybe you guys should talk this out. Colin?
Yeah. Yeah.
Bobo's here for you, so Bobo?
Yeah.
Bobo.
Yeah, I'm here. I don't know if I misheard something from a long time ago. Maybe I did.
What are you saying?
What?
Why do you keep asking Colin for free tickets?
Well, I think I made
it. Bobo, I told you. You don't ask for 3 points of rub the big. What am I, a schmuck on wheels? Here's what's going to happen. I'll give you free tickets if Anthony lets you on the bus for the entire trip.
That ain't happening.
Bobo, no free tickets. You wouldn't even understand this show. I mean, no offense.
No, I would understand it.
Oh, and he goes, no, I would understand it.
All right, good. Wait a minute.
Yeah. No, Bobo, you keep... Stop asking for free things. You're insane. You asked for, like, 5 free things on Twitter last night. tickets to this, some San Diego tickets for his cousin, fucking all-star tickets you wanted, fan fest tickets.
You're what they call a real schnorrer, Bobo.
Yeah. I got to say, for the record, the wheels have really come off this birthday celebration.
Oh, come on, Jimmy. Colin's on the phone.
It's turned into a real fucking downhill shit wagon that we're on.
Well, nobody can deny that. Somebody's got a hot girl in there. Go talk to her again.
She's very lovely.
She's sitting, she's a Dominican girl who I feel a certain love for, and we're just having a lovely chat.
Girl. I like the fact that she's a beautiful girl. Trying to have a few laughs, a little light conversation, though she's smoking. And Anthony goes, I'll buy him a fucking Desert Eagle tomorrow.
I know.
I can see her face over the phone. Oh, anyway.
Hey, you know.
Yeah.
Guy needs a little protection. He's a little protection.
Bobo Desert Eagle?
No.
Yeah.
No.
No, you should think about it.
He's very irresponsible. All right,
guys. All right, I'll stop being a vital cog. This horrible oil spill of a show.
Thank you, Carl.
Hey, thanks for the special celebrity call. See you tonight. Colin, an unconstitutional is fucking brilliant one-man show.
Yes.
It truly is a masterpiece. So
he's brilliant, and he's very funny. How you put those two things together, it's amazing.
Yeah.
Thank you, Bobo.
All right,
why are we waiting for him to sign off?
Exactly.
Hit the button.
He should have been hung up on.
What the fuck?
He contributed nothing, by the way, to that call.
No, I would understand
nothing.
It. Good.
He didn't contribute.
Like that type of person that I want to go to a bar, even though I don't drink, and get wasted.
Really?
Why? Yeah, like, he looks like he will get naked and just dance on top of the bar and be like,
yeah.
Bobo?
Who, Bobo?
Yeah.
Yeah, he probably would.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's a horrible cop.
Oh, my God.
Why is he... Is
that your face?
Oh, my God. You hear him? He got all stuttery.
Quiet.
Hi, Bobo.
He gets crazy around girls.
Yeah, all right.
Are you still there?
How are you doing?
I like your voice. You sound so sexy. Wait.
I am. I am a good guy. I can tell you that.
Yeah? What do you like doing for fun?
Oh, I play video games. I go to Met games. I enjoy movies.
Can you get tickets for that the Met game? Free tickets?
Yeah, I could. Well, I would get tickets for you if you don't mind sitting in the upper deck. The
radio. Oh, fuck. Forget about the dinner now. We're done.
Bobo!
Fuck.
Good one.
I want to, like, VIP.
Bobo, why don't you tell her some of the stuff that you're into sexually to get her a little more stimulated here? Yeah, you know, if you can't impress her with your money, impress her with your sexual prowess.
Yeah. Well, I am willing to go down on you.
Wow.
Well, I'm willing to go down. How sexy. Hey, look, I'll bite the bullet and slam my face into the baby maker if you need it.
You know, put a gun to my head.
What's your favorite position, Bobo?
Oh, I kind of like 69ing the girl.
That's a lot of work, man.
Yeah. For selfish, but he can't just go down on you and then let it be about you. He's got to be about him, too.
Again,
he's very selfish.
Yeah. So selfish.
He's a selfish lover.
I got to pee. Don't go anywhere.
Oh, okay. No problem. Go ahead, Jimmy. Bobo, what about the actual intercourse, sex?
Do you make noise when you, like, put it in?
Oh.
Do you go, like, oh.
Yeah,
the girl makes noise. She goes, "Where is it?"
They don't know.
Oh, shit.
I am a virgin, so.
Can I de-virginize you?
Oh, you could.
Oh, you could.
Wait, but how do you like 69 if you're a virgin?
Well, I don't know. For some reason,
do you see it in the video games?
Well, I've watched enough porn.
Did Luigi and Mario do that?
I've watched enough porn.
He's watched enough porn.
Wait, I'm a porn star. Well,
yeah,
star.
I know that.
Sure.
Oh, you do? And what else do you know?
I think that would be an honor to be virginized from a porn star.
Ah, now he's saying it would be an honor.
Bobo, would you talk dirty to her?
Yeah, I would.
He's already talking dirty.
Well,
I love it. He's making me like...
Bobo, give us a little sample of how you would talk to her dirty. Go ahead. You're talking to her right now, so talk to her dirty.
Yeah, I want to ram that cock in you. Why'd you take all that cum?
Where?
Oh, I want you to take that on your tits and face.
What about my asshole?
Oh, yeah, I want you to take it in your asshole. I want to ram that in your asshole. I want to ram that in your asshole.
Can I hear how you moan?
Oh, yeah. Man, it feels so good.
Oh, stop that's it. Right, you're making baby. Me so excited.
Yeah, that's right. Take
yeah, don't stop.
Baby.
Keep going. Yeah, let me hear a little word. Do you like doing baby. Animal stuff, like putting on a little, like, penguin thing or a bear?
Well, if you're into that, then...
We can foreplay.
I'm willing to...
If you got free tickets for good seats.
Mm.
Yeah, I'll definitely do that. Yeah, that's right. You like
but
that,
talk
baby.
Dirty to me, baby.
Yeah, you like that. You like that. You like that in your ass. You think is that in you?
Well, but you're going to need a little bit of foreplay, I think, before yeah. you just oh, shove it in oh, her oh. ass.
Come on, man.
Damn, he's just going straight
It's like,
ahead.
Hey, yeah. how are you doing? Let's go to the upper deck, and I'll shove it in your ass. yeah. I mean, come on, Bobo.
Where's the charm?
Yeah, you got nothing here.
We go back to the first thing I said, why I don't date.
Right.
Before dessert. Can I have sex with you?
Well, there he is.
so sexy. Babe, you have such a big anaconda. What the fuck?
Bobo, well, she's looking at
what
the photo
you
of you in those little European underwear.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
Ah.
Who kid? Bubba's talking dirty on the
Bubba's
phone right
talking
now.
Talking dirty to the lovely Mary Jean.
Oh, my God. You have a stripper here.
This is a lovely lady.
I came here just for your birthday, yo, not for Sam.
It's like 4 hours early.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
Cool, man. How you been, man?
Okay. So, what were you saying? As the cavalcade of very gettable birthday guests continued.
Cavalcade.
of my friends wishing me a happy birthday.
Bubba, yeah. are you erect?
Yep.
So hard or just hard?
No, very hard.
Oh, shit.
yeah. Why don't you give now you talk
now
dirty
I feel like I'm having phone sex though.
Yeah, talk to him a little dirty. You give him a little dirty talk.
Oh, you're looking at my ass
out. Who kid's right behind you taking pictures of her ass? He just popped right up taking some ass pics.
He goes, oh, she's a stripper. Oh, let me take a picture of her ass.
Take a picture of that ass. Pretty nice, right there, who kid?
You like it?
I love that shit.
Yeah, that's pretty nice.
It's a lot of moisture in there.
I know, it's all nice and
you hear that, Bobo? You're getting her very moist.
I'll put my dick in there right now, too.
Oh, shit. Bobo.
Bobo.
Who kid's trying to, you too.
Bobo, who kid's trying to move in on your chick? What do you got to say? Fight for her.
You got to have a contest. Who can get their dick in her ass?
Say, I'm getting you tickets to go to the Jay-Z concert tonight.
It's mine, all right?
What
there's plenty other fish in the pond, all right? This one's mine.
She blamed me.
Fish in the pond. Oh, yeah. Wow, he's sure you're a tough guy, Bobo.
I don't know, Bobo. I got a bigger dick than you, man.
Shit.
Bobo, explain what you would do to her physically that would make her want to go with you instead of Hookin.
Right.
With a little cock.
Right.
Yeah, well, as they said, I'd be willing to go down on you.
Willing.
What else would you do? What else would you do?
What else, Bobo? Come on.
I want to hear some more. I want to hear details. Would you touch my hair? Would you talk to me? Would you like not talk to me?
Yeah, paint a picture with words.
Yeah,
I would talk to you. I would also, if you're into hair pulling, I would do that.
No.
He's like selling shit. I would do that if you need me to smack that ass.
You choke me?
I perhaps would.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You choke her? Bubba's sitting there with a dead girl in the bed. She said to choke her.
Yeah.
I choked her.
Yes.
A right. She asked me a right.
She sang harder.
Yeah.
Well, he did say he would go down on her. Maybe he has a bigger tongue than mine.
Ah.
Could be.
So what else would you do now? What would you do with your dick? She might want it in her mouth, so how would you make that happen?
Bubba.
Would you ask before you do it? Or would you demand it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I demanded you suck my dick.
Yo.
How would you say?
How would you say it?
Ask. Well, tell me.
How would you say it?
Yo.
That's right, baby. Suck that dick.
What about if I'm like, suck babe, I'll dick. Pass? Would you be like, stop that?
Yeah,
Yeah, suck that.
Suck that.
What would you do with, what would you do with her ass, Bobo?
Right.
She's got a nice one.
It's perfect.
She's crazy.
I would smack that ass. I would finger it while you were sucking it, my dick.
Just what I
you
like.
You finger her ass while she's sucking your dick.
That's a freaky guy.
That Wait. Is freaky.
She's very flexible.
Yeah, so
is
she's
that like
wrapped
a 69
around.
Position again?
It's almost like a 69, but he's fucking... He's got a digit in there.
Yeah.
What kind of digit?
Bobo? Would you use your thumb?
Well, yeah, I would.
How many fingers would you try to shove up her ass, Bobo?
I would try to go five.
He's going to go big or go home.
He wants to fist your ass.
Five fingers?
Five up her
Might
ass.
Well put ten.
So far, he'd be willing to go down on you.
Yeah.
He would demand that you suck his dick while he fists your ass.
With five
no.
fingers deep.
He wouldn't fist you. It would be three fingers from one hand and two from the other. He would just have both of his hands in her asshole.
Saying, baby, suck my dick.
Yeah, suck my dick.
Suck
right.
my dick. Right.
I'd be willing. To go down on you.
Yeah, I'll make you a pussy if you suck it.
Bobo. I Bobo like this. I thought Bobo was religious.
He's a very right? sexual guy.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I know that. Oh, yeah.
What do else? You hear his dirty talk?
Oh,
so
yeah.
high.
Bobo.
What else would you do?
What else? What else would you do to satisfy this lovely woman?
Yeah, well, I'd ream it up the ass.
You like ass. You like fucking in the ass. You like anal.
He'd ram it up the ass. Wow.
And I have my hands on the tits at the same time.
Oh, hands on the tits at the same
the
time.
The same hands that you pulled out of her wow. anus? I'd give you a dirty Sanchez first. I'd make you lick my fingers clean, and then I'd hold your tits.
Holy shit. The same dirty hands.
Zach, would you at least Purell them first? Have you pulled them out of her hiney?
Bobo. So it's all about the ass?
Do you like boobs?
Well, yeah. Yeah, I like boobs also. And yeah, I would ram it up your pussy also.
Oh.
I think I just want to stick to the ass thing now. You know, I've never done anal, so you could de-virginize me like
that. Oh, imagine
well,
that.
How big are you fully erect?
It's about 5 to 4.
5 to 4.
5 to 4.
I got a small cock.
Bubba has the micro penis.
The micro.
Yeah.
Do I have to search for it?
He's got a lot of pubic hair, if that helps.
Like,
nice.
I feel so...
Bobo, anything else? Yeah. Anything else, a fantasy that you have with a woman that you could do with Mary Jean?
Well, I'd have to say...
You like my pussy some more?
Yep. I would love that.
Would you lick her ass?
Fingers.
Five yeah. fingers.
Everything.
Everything in your ass.
Yeah. Everything.
Going
your,
there.
Your ass is like the junk drawer.
Yeah. Yeah.
I would people take try my, to put it like a table, but.
Yeah.
I would take my wool hat.
Maybe a lighter, some scissors, a pen.
Yeah. Paper clips.
My right. Dick.
Rubber bands.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, well, Bobo, you sound like you're making. You sound like you're making some headway here with Mary Jean.
I think I like you.
Do you have a Twitter, Mary Jean?
I do have a Twitter.
You should give it out because Bobo would love to follow you on Twitter.
Is he going
to
ask for free stuff?
Yep. He might.
Like free blowjobs?
Yep. He probably would.
Do you, Bobo, give, do you give not free blowjobs? Well, now you just piqued my interest here.
Oh, I thought he had his checkbook out.
No, he's looking at where I work, headquarters.
No, but I was just thinking checkbook is such a 1988 reference. It's all it about is. PayPal, you silly.
It is PayPal.
PayPal cash.
Cash.
Yeah,
there
but some
you go.
Of us, you know, PayPal.
Stay off
better.
The grid, right? I hear you. Enough.
No paper trails.
No paper trail. We don't like that at all.
Really? I don't mind trail.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's
yeah
PayPal
you could buy too. Stuff and, like, you know, yeah. You report your taxes and you're like,
oh, of course you do. I hear you. Believe me. Do it all the time.
It's XO Mary Jean XO.
Yeah.
XO Mary Jean XO.
Like hugs and kisses, because I love to kiss and give hugs to everybody. And...
Yeah. Let's see this
hugging
pic.
That cock.
Pop that pic right. up. Let me see. Oh, my God.
Oh, shit.
That is a sexy-ass pic of you.
Look at that.
That's pretty me. Good.
Jesus.
Good at Bobo. Bobo. Bubba.
Yeah.
Are you masturbating?
Yeah. Are you jerking off?
Let me hear a little something.
Yeah, I am.
Oh, yeah, don't stop.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, you're about to come, baby.
Yeah. Yeah, it's feeling good.
Is it nice and tight, your hands? Like.
Yeah, that's great. I'm thinking about you there on that. I'm thinking about that feeling of it in your pussy.
Yeah. I'm ramping my ass.
Right.
Yeah. Not that.
I ain't no special people to get horny.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Ah, shit.
Are you masturbating?
He's handy capable.
Yeah, I am.
Oh, shit.
Oh, yeah, he is.
Oh, give him some talk there to get him along. exactly.
Don't stop. Keep going.
Yeah.
Keep touching yourself. Yeah.
You're masturbating on air right now.
Oh, Jesus.
It's wet over there, huh?
Keep going.
Yeah.
Because that was it.
Did he come?
Yeah.
Was that? No? Okay, keep going.
Yeah, I am.
Yeah.
Bobo, DJ Whoo Kid's taking his shirt off listening to you.
I just took my socks off, man.
Bobo, what are you imagining? Tell us what you're imagining with Mary Jean.
Yeah, I'm just imagining that she's in that target. She's just grabbing it.
Are you fingering my ass?
Ramming it in her, like,
just know what she
like. Yeah, do you have fucking, are you two ankles deep in her ass right now?
Yeah, exactly. How is this happening? What is this?
Happy birthday, Jim.
Yes. My birthday. It is
happy
a hot
birthday,
chick.
Jimmy.
And I'm listening to this fucking dunce. Fucking play with his ugly dick. Shut up.
This is the best thing that ever happened.
Bobo's birthday, man.
His ugly. Oh, this fucking thunderhead.
Oh, shit.
Playing with his fucking fruit roll up looking chewed up dick. His fucking dog bone dick.
Hilarious.
I'm so using that.
Oh, I've had enough of this. All right, we heard you.
I'm coming.
Do you have a
shut up,
Bobo?
Happy birthday, nigga.
Bobo's that type that I keep my watch on while having sex and be like, hurry up, please.
Oh, like he's fucking you too long.
Five fingers, come on.
Yeah. I gotta go clean out under my nails.
I'll go 10 for you.
Oh, ten
fingers.
I want you to practice. Wet them and find an electrical socket and show us how you put them in her ass.
Yeah, practice on the toaster.
You fucking vibe-killing, fucking shoot-up cock idiot.
Holy shit.
All right, well, that was really hot. Thanks for calling.
Very sexy.
Thank you.
It's nice talking to you,
yeah,
Bobo.
Yeah, pleasure.
All right, take it easy, Bobo. There he goes.
He came.
You know what that's like, winding him up like that, now letting him out into society?
I'm just like, what am I doing? First of all, I had to be at the gym in less than an hour. This fucking gorgeous girl here.
Yeah.
We chatted for a minute, and then we all had to divert from the unpleasant confrontation over Zimmerman that was about to happen. and then this fucking dunce calls in, and then it's fucking Bert Kreischer, and then fucking Colin, guys who I'm friends with.
Yeah.
What happened?
Oh, jeez.
It's so promising.
I feel bad.
I think you got a little too excited for it.
I did. How do you start off with Tyson? You can't start with Mike Tyson.
No E-Rock or Opie like you thought.
They're really not here.
I know. Opie texted me.
Oh, man. From the beach house?
Yes.
Are you invited out?
I hope not. Because I'm fucking driving to Pennsylvania for a gig.
Oh, you are?
I have to say no.
Yeah.
I'm sure it's an open invite.
Yeah. All right. Well, you know what?
This has been a delightful show. Because I would have hated. Thank God there was no like lap dance or anything. Because who wants that on their birthday?
I put pasties on just for you.
Oh, damn it!
Look,
I'm glad we didn't get to any of that.
Wow.
Because, wow,
that is. Hold on. I gotta take a picture of that.
Wait, but I have to take this off. It'll look better.
Okay.
Yeah. We don't disagree.
I got no qualms, as they say. Not a qualm to be found.
But, you know, good thing we had that fucking fool on the phone.
Twice.
Yeah, twice. Ugh.
Oh, my God. This is just amazing.
Wow, wait.
Damn.
It's very lovely.
All right. That looks great.
Yeah, I'll take a photo.
Okay, yeah, Jenny, take a picture.
Now you guys go all masturbate to my pasties
later
on. Oh,
man.
Shit.
That would look, those are great, what they call fucking tits. Yeah.
Boobies?
Yeah, what are that? Yeah. I like saying tits.
I'll take a photo of us together. Okay.
Wow. Oh, that's wonderful.
Nice as fucking tits.
Yes.
Well, what a day. What a day. Jimmy's birthday.
I don't feel like I'm naked, though, because the nipples are not showing.
Yeah, although you didn't show us your panties, but whatever.
Oh, panties?
All right, let me get back to the positioning again.
Oh, man.
You guys want me to strip? Where's the $20?
Well, I bet we could come up with $20.
Oh, my goodness.
Swipe that card in the ass.
Swipe the card? Yeah.
Black card, you mean.
Oh, yeah. Wow, that looks great. Yeah, you're very frilly.
Very lovely.
Oh, Jimmy.
All right, you can meet Mary Jane at Headquarters Gentlemen's Club Tuesday night at 10 o'clock for the Wild Cherry Burlesque Night featuring porn star DJ Brittany Andrews. So go to HQ New York. HQ is just the letters and then New York is the whole word. HQNewYork.com for more details. Or if you want to follow Mary Jane on Twitter, you can just go to XO Mary Jane XO.
Jimmy, think of it this way.
Now, Mary
Jane. It can
Jane.
Only go up from here as far as your day, your birthday.
I have a shit day. I got to go to the gym, almost have a stroke.
Just look at a picture, Jim, and you'll be okay. Oh.
And then go to have shit installed in my apartment.
What about tonight?
I'm doing a set, then I'm doing Artie Lang show, and then I'm driving to fucking Pennsylvania for a gig.
Things are looking up. I just got a text message.
Yeah?
Tell Jimmy happy birthday. I wish him 10 more. From Justin
Ten
Stangle.
Fingers?
Justin Stangle.
Justin Stangle.
Oh, all right, well.
That's, you know.
The eye roll.
That's fucking tremendous.
Right.
I mean, that's very nice. Thank God. That's good.
Oh.
As I look at my fucking gray hair in this photo.
Oh, Jimmy.
Let's see how it came out.
You don't have it grown long enough to be able to use the to go to John Sahag and get a little color in there when you do TV.
Get out of here. I'm a hairdresser.
Yes.
I can do it for him.
You can do it for him. Well, you can't color hair that short, though, right?
Yeah, you can.
Yeah?
It's still hair.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Uh-oh. It's still hair.
It sure is.
Words of wisdom, Lloyd. Words of wisdom.
Yeah. Wasn't exactly a lap dance.
I
she
know.
She literally stood up and she shook her hips back and forth and said, "You got $20." Story of my
Happy
life.
Happy birthday. Yeah.
Yeah, terrific.
Oh,
it
God.
It just couldn't have been any better
That's
today.
Terrible. Well, we do have, I guess the listeners have a birthday wish for Jimmy, right?
That's right.
We have that?
You want to hear
I'd
it?
Love to hear it. This is from your people, Jimmy.
Oh. Happy birthday to Jim Norton. Here's some love from your fans.
I'd be in a big ask you to everybody who doesn't love Jim Norton. It's his fucking birthday, for Pete's sake. Fuck you, and happy birthday, Jim Norton.
I would say happy birthday to Uncle Paul, Chip, Edgar, and Josh. We love you, Jimmy. No homo.
Jimmy, happy birthday, my man. Go get some birthday blumpkins. I would call on the Jim Norton show, but you guys keep me on hold for fucking ever. But whatever. Happy motherfucking birthday, man.
Hey, Jim Norton, this is your old friend Herbie Robinson from Cleveland. Happy birthday, you fucking man lover.
Yar modu lebar, yar modu lebar, yar modu lebar, unde lundrarion. Vivitka du lebar, vivitka du lebar, vivitka du lebar, unde lundrarion.
Look at the joy in Jim's face right now.
We love you, Jimmy.
Right.
Happy birthday, Jimmy. Don't be depressed, little buddy. If that was a girl, I'd follow your load. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, nice. Daddy.
Jim Norton, this is Pete Best. Happy birthday. Son of a bitch, I could have been a Beatle.
Happy birthday, fuck you. Happy birthday,
Why wouldn't we?
Happy birthday, fuck you. Happy birthday, fuck you. Happy birthday, dear Jimmy, and fuck you.
Jimmy, happy birthday, Jimmy. I'm so glad to think of you.
How long is this?
Jimmy! Happy birthday, big boy! Happy room exit day, Jimmy.
Right.
Hope you came out with your tongue out.
Wow. Hi, dirty boy.
Just left.
Happy birthday. Look at that juicy clit.
Oh.
We should have lunch.
Happy birthday, fucking Norton.
What?
Happy fucking birthday.
One more.
Happy birthday. Everybody wishing. Woo!
You like that, Jimmy?
No. Who cares?
They love you.
I love them, too.
I showed this guy some pussy or something.
Yeah, exactly.
I was thinking that.
Well.
She's Dominican, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, I didn't see the pussy yet. This is very rare.
Oh, shit.
You calling Dominicans. See it.
When I went Dominican, it was like $50. I saw everything.
Like right away, right?
I even got a baby.
Damn.
Send $20 a, you know, a couple of weeks.
Yeah,
every
that's
week.
It.
Yeah. My wife don't hear this shit.
No.
Yeah, yeah.
Holy cow. I'm like,
all right. Well, you know what? I guess, Jimmy, I'm sorry. I was hoping this birthday celebration would be a little better.
Could it be?
Dr. Steve.
That's great.
Dr. Steve's checking in.
Oh, cool.
By text.
Oh, is he a real doctor?
And he
he is. That's what makes this so exciting. He went to medical school. Now here he is.
He must be really smart.
Yeah, he is a very bright guy. He's a really bright guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, all right.
Well, he didn't even say happy birthday. He was just texting me. I thought it was like a happy birthday,
no,
Jimmy.
What was it?
I don't know. He was. Here he is again. No. The wonderful doctor. Have a great weekend, pal.
Oh, so sweet of the doctor.
Yeah.
It's really fucking terrific.
Oh, shit.
All right. Well,
all right.
Good.
It's been...
No, you were great. The fucking calls were amazing.
We can get Bobo back on.
Yeah. Oh, Jesus.
Oh, shit.
Let's hear another masturbation section.
Yeah, I think...
Yeah, no, we got to wrap up this fucking... I mean, how much excitement can one guy...
Yeah.
Fucking take his birthday abomination. But it was fun to see Adam. I was happy Adam came in.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun.
Thank you for coming in.
We'll see you Monday after a wonderful weekend. And stay tuned for the, already in progress, the Sam Roberts After Show.
That's right.
Already in progress.
Oh, I didn't mean to impede on your...
Oh, who cares?
Your time.
That fucking... Oh, I mean... No. Terrible. That.
I mean, my guest will be DJ Whoo Kid.
I assume DJ Whoo Kid and perhaps the lovely Mary Jane
will
stick around.
We're going to take this birthday celebration.
And we get Bobo on the phone. You can jacking off or something.
Why
like
not?
That.
Have Bobo beat off for another fucking 45 minutes. All right, everybody. Happy birthday, Jim. I love you.
Happy birthday,
Jim. Thank you, guys.
One of my dearest friends.
Thank you so much.
And we'll see you after this weekend.
Yes.
Bye, guys.